Sounds good.
Hey everyone, this is Mike Tsaikotyk Kelly for Zero Tolerance Games here, joined with our glorious leader, the Kim Jong one and only, Mr. Latency.
What's up?
And the dick bandit himself, Mr. Cupcake Troll.
Hello.
We're doing our podcast, vlogcast, broadcast, whatever you want to call it. I'm going to be playing KI, so you have something to look at instead of just a static image. I know Latency wanted to start off with things we've been playing this week and our thoughts on them, or, you know, currently streaming, roughly, approximately. So we'll get right into that. Today, and almost every other day this week, I've been playing the hell out of KI Season 3. I didn't like Season 1. I played a preview of it at EVO. I didn't like Season 2 when I played a preview build of it at CEO. Having a hell of a lot of fun with this. Still having fun with Hitman. Not really feeling R-E-Zero or Neptune EAU that much. But that's about everything I've been playing, so I'll just pass it over to Latency himself. What have you been playing?
I've been playing the shit out of Get Windows 10 to Unfuck Itself. That's like Dark Souls of the computer world, man. Like, it's like worst fucking thing ever.
You know what's bad when the tech guy is like, that's not an error I've seen before.
It was more than that. It was, that's not an error I've seen before. Get me a beer.
Yeah.
So shout outs to Saniti and coming to my rescue. At the end, we ended up doing what I was going to have to do anyway, but at least I knew I had exhausted all of my options by the 3.5 hour mark. Yeah, so that was a nightmare. This was all in an effort to also join you guys in playing Killer Instinct, which I have yet to actually be able to do. So Tuesday night, I upgraded to Windows 10. I downloaded Killer Instinct. I bought everything. I unlocked the game. I was like, all right, cool. It's 1 o'clock in the morning. I'm gonna go to bed. Came home the next day. Store didn't open. Xbox application didn't open. And since the Xbox application couldn't stay open to sign me into Killer Instinct, I had none of the content I had previously purchased the day before for $60. So stayed up till about 1:30, 2 o'clock in the morning trying to fix that shit. Tsaikotyk helped me out considerably. And then the next night, I had Tini come over and. We ended up resetting the OS, which uninstalled all of my applications, which means the only Steam game I actually have installed right now is Devil May Cry 4 Special Edition, which I don't think has happened since I got a Steam account. I don't think I've had just one Steam game on my computer at any given point in time.
I have zero. This is unheard of.
Yeah, so prior to the Tuesday upgrade and subsequent Windows 10 fiasco, I did play through StarCraft 2 Nova Covert Ops from front to back, all three missions that are currently available. Due to OBS having the hotkey to turn off your microphone set as F10 and StarCraft having the hotkey to open the menu set to F10, I will be restreaming myself playing all three of those missions on hard mode. Coming up pretty soon. So stay tuned for that. I didn't get to play any Senran Kagura this weekend because I was doing battle with Microsoft. So that's pretty much the extent of what I've actually been able to get done this week. And in terms of Nova Covert Ops being the closest thing that I'm ever going to see to StarCraft Ghost, I enjoyed it for what it was worth. I'm interested in the kind of, I mean, it's bullshit writing. They're just like, oh, she has amnesia. Why did she have amnesia? What did she do while she had amnesia? Like, okay, that's just fucking lazy writing. But now you've got me. I want to know what happened, you assholes.
Yeah, feeling.
Yeah. So, it's one of those style games. The gameplay is, I like the gameplay. The missions that I've played are very micro-oriented, and it does have a lot of that traditional StarCraft II campaign-style stuff where Nova has a bunch of gear, her Black Ops units have a lot of customizable gear. So, like, one of the things, each you get a bunch of, or you're able to unlock a bunch of upgrades for your units that they just like immediately start with. And like the barracks units all have a set of upgrades. The factory units all have a set of upgrades. But one of the things you have to do is you can only assign one upgrade per unit per structure. So you get super stim packs, which instead of dealing damage to your units and making them shoot faster and run faster, heals your units and makes them shoot faster and run faster.
Cute.
And so, but you can't just put that on all of your Marines and Marauders and whatever the third unit that I'm forgetting that comes out of that. Oh, Reapers. That can't go on all three units. So you then have to go, okay, well, I want super stim on my Marines, and I'm going to put this upgrade on my Marauders that lets me build them without having a tech lab, because that's totally fair, and let's just double create Marauders with reactors on all my barracks. And then you can put spider mines on your Reapers, which function exactly as they did in StarCraft 1. You can put... Okay, the highlight of that entire game was being able to put Reaper jump jets on my siege tanks. Balance.
Wow. So can you start producing Marines from your command center?
No, I haven't seen that yet, but it might be coming. Who knows? I just felt like Marines. I just felt like Marines that started with combat shields and got stim packs that healed them was already broken enough. And then Nova has customizable equipment, and I didn't really get to play through all of her customizable equipment, because you can take away the C10 canister rifle and give her a shotgun, which sounds like an interesting option as well. She also, in the final mission, she also gets what's effectively a StarCraft lightsaber, and has melee combat with that. She also gets, like, Kerrigan's dash attack that just slaughters everything in her way. So, it's entertaining. I enjoyed it, and I definitely, part of the reason for going back and playing it in hard mode is to use all the gear and progress through that way. But also not be constantly muting myself every time I bring up a game.
Yeah, so, sounds like a good plan.
I will actually try some Killer Instinct today, hopefully for the first time. Cupcake Troll, how about you? What have you been up to?
Well, I just finished up with Danganronpa, was it like last week or the week before or whatever. That was super fun, even though I did have a bit of a breakdown for Chapter 2. We don't talk about that. I did find that it's super easy to overthink that game and think you know anything. And I think the running tally out of all of my conspiracy theories was one out of who the fuck knows how many. And the one that I got right was because I was joking. I was joking. I was like, oh, you know, not gonna say spoilers, but like, dude blanks blanks. And like, three lines later, it's like, dude blank blanks. I'm like, holy fuck, I was joking. Yeah, it's like you think you know, but you don't. I was half right with the whole story overall. I just had characters swapped. But I mean, it was super fun. I liked the whole trial mechanics. They were super fun. I enjoyed all of it, and I think all of it fit. But I think the part I didn't like the most was the wrap-up comic segment. I don't think there was any other way they could have done it better and it fit, but I just personally didn't enjoy it as much as pretty much anything else that the trial segments had to offer.
Okay, you're specifically talking about that segment of the trials, like that particular mechanic?
Yeah, just that particular, like, I thought the whole, like, I liked the Hangman's Gambit, that was cool. I liked the, you know, just the general, like, you have the bullets and sometimes a bullet you have doesn't contradict anything, but there's a statement that the people are making that contradicts. So you have to absorb that as your bullet. I thought it was all really, really fun. I haven't played an Ace Attorney game in quite some time, so I can't say if it has more to the trial segments than the Ace Attorney games, because it could have just as much, it could have more, it could have less, but I really enjoyed it. I thought the whole thing was really fun. The story was super cool. It did keep you on your toes quite regularly. And like I said, it's just super easy to overthink. And I think that was my downfall going into chapter two, along with just sort of everything that else that had happened that day sort of put me in a really wonky mindset. But no, I mean, it came back strong for sure. I definitely recommend it. Even if you're not a super visual novel fan, there's still enough to it to keep you interested, I would say.
It's funny that you bring up Ace Attorney, because that was my immediate reaction the very first time I played the game on Vita, was because I played Ace Attorney 1 all the way through to the end, and some of Ace Attorney 3, like the beginning segments, and my immediate knee-jerk as soon as I got to the trial was, this is like Ace Attorney, but with actual gameplay.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I felt like the trial segments were so much stronger because I felt like I was doing things and not just objecting to random statements because... Danganronpa felt like there was some deductive logic involved, and Ace Attorney was just like, just shout objection until you get it right.
Yeah, that's what I remember of Ace Attorney. Like, the first one I played way back when was just... You know, you're shouting objective until you get it right, where at least with Danganronpa, you actually have to sit and think about what clues you have versus what people are saying. And yeah, you know, there is a quote-unquote fail state, but you just continue from, like, the last trial checkpoint type of thing. But at least there was a little more behind it in terms of making sure you had what was right and paying attention to what people were saying. Like, there were a lot of... Like, I think it was toward the end, it finally sunk in that, you know, I should really just wait and listen to what everybody has to say and then make my decision. Because at first I was just making straight assumptions off of, okay, you know, because I'm playing it on, like, kind or whatever the middle difficulty was, you know, I'd only have the one bullet. So I would be really trying to match that bullet with a statement, and I was... wrong a lot of times. And then it was a lot of like, okay, I need to let this whole thing play out the first time. And then from there, it's like, okay, now I have that second of, okay, did the bullet match anything or did a statement match anything? So I liked that, where it was a little bit more to it than just like, okay, that. Okay, no, that didn't work. Okay, now that. And so yeah, it was fun. I thoroughly enjoyed it. I felt they did a good job. I'm super hyped for number two coming out.
Yep,
pre-orders open up I'm super Monday. Happy that... Yeah, pre-orders open up Monday. And I'm super happy that Byakuya gets fat.
as far as you know.
As far as I know, yes. No, Byakuya was one of my least liked characters. It was just that stereotypical rich kid arrogance that I was just like, whatever, I'm done with you. And seeing the trailer for 2 and that he's a fucking fatty was just like, okay, at least I have that.
The thing I felt about Byakuya when during my brief stint in playing that game was he was very much, to me, he very much represented, and I don't know how many of you have read or the novel or the manga for Battle Royale, but he was very much the Kiriyama character to me.
And I can't say I've read the manga.
He was kind of that privileged, like, sort of psychotic play the game style character.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
he wasn't at all dissuaded by being in that situation. He was just like, oh, that's what I have to do to get out of here? Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, but like I said, happy to have played that. Looking forward to number 2. I started up Hyperdimension Neptunia Rebirth 2 Sisters Generation on PC. Yeah, just a little bit, right? I forgot how fun the Neptune games are. I will admit, I do miss the original cast. They feel better than the sisters in 2, but I mean, core gameplay is all still there. It's pretty much the exact same game with different characters. I need to get back into that because my crippling Warframe addiction has started back up again.
Yeah, we've noticed. It was hard to get you in here.
Well, I was waiting for you guys to say something. Like, all I just heard was like, I can be home by X time. I'm like, all right, they'll let me know what time then. And then I just get the message like, yo, dog. It was like, oh, fuck. Okay, cool. Let me fucking get in here. So,
it was funny. Yeah. So we were talking about it, and I sent a message in the general Discord, and I was like, hey, Cupcake Troll, you available? And then we didn't get a reply, and so Tsaikotyk and I were kind of sitting around going, okay, well, what do we do? And I was like, fuck it, I'm gonna message him on Facebook. And yeah, Sai goes, try Steam, it'll be a lot faster. And it was instantaneous reply.
Yeah, no, like, I don't have Discord, like, open, unless I'm actually using it. I've always got my phone in front of me, and so notifications from Facebook will reach me there. And if I'm in Warframe, yeah, 11 times out of 10, just hitting me up via Steam Messenger is going to be the most efficient. And it was funny because I wasn't actually doing anything. Like, I was just there, like, fucking fashion frame. Like, ooh, this color looks good with this color.
Sitting and staring at a menu.
Yeah, pretty much just staring at a menu because I knew we were going to be doing this. And I'm like, all right, well, I don't want to start anything. So I'm just like...
Trying to get your mountain skin to match.
Yeah, pretty much. Outside of that, I don't have anything else on my plate. But coming out soon, I'm just going to double check something.
I was going to say, yeah, let's move into the upcoming segment because I think the two of you have something that's pretty much going to hijack the channel for the rest of foreseeable time.
Yeah, but haven't you also started playing Uncharted 3 for the second time now?
Oh, yes, yes. I will. So because Danganronpa is over and not, you know, completely taking over the stream because I, like the fucking genius I am, decided, hey, we should fucking VO this shit, which probably extended it
several
weeks longer than it needed to be. Yeah. I'm getting back to Uncharted 3. The first time I had a pretty major technical issue with the sound because I fucked up some options and I was reverberating like a motherfuck because I chose, you know, use microphone instead of use device audio. Go me. And then for some reason, second time around, I'm having game echo in certain awkward spots and I don't know why. So hopefully, when I pick that shit back up on Tuesday, that won't be there. So Uncharted 3 is a bit of an audio curse for me right now. So
speaking of currently playing for Cupcake Troll, what Metal Gear are you on right now?
I am on the very first, the original MSX version of Metal Gear.
Okay, I wasn't sure if you had completed that by now.
No, I'm about halfway through. That got sidelined because of Danganronpa. Again, just time crunch with games that are coming out that we want to play. It was like, MSX can wait. Danganronpa was starting to get really, really good. And, you know, like, answers. I fucking need answers. And I got answers. They weren't answers to questions I was really asking, but they were answers. But yeah, in terms of current, that's pretty much it.
So let's talk about upcoming, because I know you guys have a game coming out soon.
Dark Souls.
Yep, Dark Souls 3.
Which, depending on who you ask, is technically already out.
Yeah, Dark Souls 3 is March 24th.
Yeah, good news.
I was gonna say,
Alex.
Well, yeah.
You're not gonna get any viewers who are waiting for their copies. It's not how this game works.
Yeah, it was 100% dependent on whether or not you were a streamer and whether or not you had the patience to make a JPPSN account.
Or if you're on Xbox One, because then you could buy the international version and it actually works. But you could buy the Japanese version and then download
gross.
In English. Yeah.
Gross.
Lovely.
Yet another reason the Xbox One is more attractive than Windows 10. Yeah, I've legitimately said a couple of times, and I'll say it here so that it's recorded for future use. Based on my experience with Windows 10 thus far, and if I could take all the knowledge I've absorbed now, go back in time, and talk to myself, if I wanted to play Killer Instinct this bad, I'd have bought an Xbox One on Monday.
And paid for gold?
Just
to play online?
And all the fucking bullshit retarded hoops that, like, the amount of torment that I've gone through is the equivalent, it weighs heavier than the financial damage from having to purchase an Xbox. But it's here, it's queer, but I'm gonna play it anyway. So yeah, you guys got Dark Souls coming up. Anything else on the docket incoming?
Uncharted
on its way to Zero Tolerance games shortly.
I think that's it. I think that's everything. Those three games.
You might want to start over because Nick was still talking when you were going.
Oh. Yeah. Uncharted 4, Danganronpa 2, Dark Souls, Doom, when that comes out.
Doom I'm actually interested in, but I haven't put any money down on. Like, I want reviews and I want, like, gameplay from people that I actually give a shit about before I invest in Doom.
Fair enough.
100%, because when modern shooters tell me they're gonna be more like old school, we get shit like Duke Nukem Forever. So, I'm mildly terrified. It sounds like the people behind it want to make a classic arena shooter, with more traditional ultra violence Doom gameplay and a little bit less Doom 3 survival horror gameplay.
Like Doom 3, though. It wasn't a bad game. What people expected.
Exactly that. Exactly 100% that. So, like, I'm really on the fence. I really, really, really want Doom to be good, but I don't have enough faith to slap money down and pick it up at launch. So I had kind of forgotten about that. That is on my docket. The closed beta test is live currently, sort of, depending on who you are and whether or not it decides to actually run. So I was interested in that. I mean, coming up on ZTG for me, I'm going to be pretty much any time I play Senran Kagura, it's going to be on stream, so you guys will be able to enjoy all the anime titty. I want to play more Pokken because I'm really fucking enjoying that game. I haven't started playing Killer Instinct yet, but every other fighting game on my list, Pokken is kind of on top of. In terms of the fact that I was playing SF5 with Siniti the other night while we were reinstalling Windows a couple of times, and I was getting frustrated by Street Fighter V because, well, A, because Siniti plays Karin, but B, because Street Fighter V very much feels like a game of I lost because I pressed a button. And because of the way the rock, paper, scissors works in Pokken, I feel like 99% of the time I lost because I didn't press a button or because I pressed the wrong button. So I like pressing buttons. Killer Instinct has active defense and combo breakers. So I'm hoping that my desire to push more buttons will actually help more than hinder in that. So I do want to get back to playing Pokken. I don't know if I'm going to stream it on ZTG or if I'm going to stream it on my personal channel or if I'm even going to stream it at all. Star Fox Zero comes out, I think, this month. End of the month.
Again until, like, May.
Did he get delayed a fucking again? Like, okay, hang on, hold the fucking phone. This is what computers are for.
Right.
Star Fox Zero. Official site. I don't actually expect the official site to have a release date, but I'll open it anyway. Release dates worldwide April 22nd, 2016. So Star Fox Zero is coming at the end of the month. I'll probably stream that. I'll probably play a bunch of that off stream, but I'll probably stream that too. Star Fox 64 was the first game I had for the Nintendo 64, and it was, like, until the dying days of the N64, it was, like, my favorite N64 game. I love the shit out of Star Fox 64. And everything that came after it, I played, but it never gave me that feeling of joy that I got from playing Star Fox 64. Like, I played Star Fox Adventures. That game is fucking horrible, and this is coming from somebody that finished it. I played Star Fox Assault all the way through the end. Star Fox Assault had some ideas, like the thought was there, but it had too many of them and didn't flesh enough of them out. That like on foot vehicle transition thing just wasn't, and the fact that every fucking gun felt exactly the same on foot, just like it didn't work the way they wanted it to. It felt very rushed, like they didn't have all the ideas in place, or they didn't put all the ideas in place. So Star Fox Assault could have used a lot more fleshing out and could have theoretically been a better game, but it wasn't. So Star Fox Zero has me really hopeful. I mean, Platinum Games has their fucking hand in this. Like, and when has Platinum ever actually disappointed me?
Never. Well, maybe Anarchy Reigns, but
I haven't played a whole lot of that, and Bayonetta is in that fucking game, so I don't know if that can even if it ends up being mediocre, I don't think it could be a disappointment.
Then again, it's on almost the same level as Senran Kagura, just like mindlessly punch the shit out of things. So.
Yeah. So, and I mean, I don't always enjoy that, but when I do, there's usually titty involved. So I mean, you know, Bayonetta's in the game. I mean, how bad could it be? Plus, the other thing I've been told is that Anarchy Reigns has one of the best fucking soundtracks in existence.
It does.
So.
I would say MGRR replaced it for me as my favorite Platinum game soundtrack, but.
Okay, yeah, MGRR. I should finish that game at some point too. That game was really good.
Yeah, it's super fun.
For what it's worth, for you guys, and more to the people watching, the people in bronze this week are much better than they were last week. Because last week was the end of a season, and this week is the start of one, so it's.
The people in bronze don't belong in bronze.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was like playing Street Fighter V at launch. It's just like, everybody's in bronze! And, you know, sometimes you got smoke weed every day, 69-69, and other times you got TS-Sabin.
Yeah.
So. shoutouts to Nerd Josh, who doesn't like actually have his handle registered on like anything and has to use like alternate names or weird spellings of his handle because people impersonate him and everything.
Oh, good shit.
Yeah, he was making posts the other day about how if you fight people with these names, they're not me. In Killer Instinct and Street Fighter V.
Nice.
So, other than that, I'm trying to think of like what else is coming out that I'm hyped for. Oh, of course, of fucking course. So these guys are gonna hijack most of April with Dark Souls 3 streams, which is perfectly fine, because I'm gonna hijack most of May with Overwatch streams, because I have been hype as fuck about that game since the Pixar trailer that they released at BlizzCon. I immediately opted into the beta, which I still have absolutely zero access to and don't expect to have any access to until the beginning of May, when all the pre-orders get the closed-ish beta access. But I did get to play some of that at a friend's house. Did enjoy it. We'll probably end up playing a lot of Reaper because my aim is terrible and he has twin shotguns. So that worked out in my favor. May is going to be the month of Overwatch. Which is funny because I don't think the game actually technically releases until the end of the month.
Yep.
But
some of us
the
are on team
beta.
Overwatch and know that.
Yeah. But the beta starts at the beta access starts at the beginning of the month, so that'll be fun. I'm pretty antsy. Can't wait for that.
Yeah, I was kind of in that same boat as you were. Like, oh, this looks like it's really really cool, and then. Same thing, like I immediately signed up for beta, didn't get any, and then I just lost all interest. And then I saw TB's video on Battleborn. I'm like, I'm kind of actually more interested in Battleborn.
I haven't watched anything for Battleborn, mostly because I expect it to be a steaming pile of shit like everything Gearbox works on that's not named Borderlands.
the original Borderlands specifically, because some of those Borderlands games have been pretty shit.
I mean, Tales was a Telltale game, so... I personally enjoyed Borderlands 2 more than Borderlands 1.
So you said the last time we played Borderlands 2. And then you changed your mind about halfway into the unskippable tutorial section. And you're like, maybe you're right.
Yeah. I think we can all agree that the pre-sequel was a cash grab and a big fuck.
Oh, yeah.
How do we make more money out of this game? Well, we take the same game, but we change the characters, and we make Handsome Jack, like, a lead heroic role, because he was a great anti-villain hero. He was funny, and lol, and Anthony Birch feels like he's God now.
Yeah, I actually thankfully got that for free, because when I upgraded my video card, it was just a free code. So I didn't spend any money on it, and I'm glad I didn't.
On that note, there are two games I have that were free with my video card, and I still haven't played Assassin's Creed 4 or Splinter Cell Conviction.
Nice.
Actually, I launched Assassin's Creed 4 only to find out that people's eyes kept flashing blue and red because apparently lighting is hard or something.
Yeah, I actually noticed that with some of the things in KI, like with Sadira. Depending on which player you are, her hair will go in front of her eyes, and you can still see her eye through her hair, but it doesn't glow like it normally does. So at first I'm thinking to myself, huh, this isn't quite what, you know, Mike doesn't like, because it's not multiple colors, one's just not glowing. And then I like actually won a game versus Mike, and I'm like, oh my god, I'm on player one. And because her hair is different on each side, it didn't cover the eye. I'm like, oh wait, they're both supposed to glow. Awkward. So yeah.
Interesting. Well, so, miscellaneous nonsense about the channel and about video games and about stuff. Tracer's butt. That was a thing.
Yeah, it was.
That happened.
And it's been getting blown up everywhere because fuck Blizzard.
Oh, did you see the Black Desert online?
Yeah.
That was amazing. That was fucking amazing. They're basically, they put somebody in like orange and yellow tinted pants and gave them the Tracer pose, except it was male.
That's awesome.
And they said they were adding butt poses to all the characters, and that it was great because it was also a plug for one of their updates too. It's like, yeah, we're releasing this when we release our new blankety blank update. And I was like, yeah,
that's fantastic.
That's fucking hilarious. Yeah, I heard about it. I looked into it a little bit, and then I stopped because my brain started hurting. I was just like, all right, this is just one of those things that the more I try and give a damn, just the more angry I'm going to be about it.
Your palms had already hit the back of your eye sockets and you still wanted to press harder?
Pretty much. I was just like, really? Really? It's like, it doesn't make sense for the character? Like, that was the whole, like, it wasn't the fact that, oh, it's showing her butt. It's that pose doesn't make sense for the character, and that pose is sexualizing the character. And it's like, huh?
And that was like 100% of the frustrating factor was that person like specifically dismisses Widowmaker like in their opening statements.
And yeah, and not the thing is to me, it's like it's not even just Widowmaker. It's like the whole cast is sexualized.
I'm not offended by the sexualization of women. I'm offended by the sexualization of this particular woman. What are we even talking about anymore?
Yeah, it was something that has to do with that the guy's daughter looks up to her as a role model, and it was like, what? Like,
for anybody who has no idea, for anybody who has no idea what we're talking about, just go watch Total Biscuit's video on Winston. It's fantastic.
Yeah, strong animal characters in Overwatch.
So, more importantly, for anybody who has no idea what the fuck we're talking about, Tracer had, I think it's a victory pose in her character model, where she, and I think it's more specifically like a play of the game pose or something.
She turns
where
around.
Where she stands. Yeah, she turns around with her hands on her hips.
No, it's not even on her hip. She's holding her two guns.
Okay.
She's holding her two guns, and she
turns around
and looks
over her shoulder.
Goddamn camera.
Yeah.
What in the actual fuck?
And somebody was
like Hanzo has that exact same pose.
Yep,
and that
and
man
I love,
is topless.
I love the debate that if we put Hanzo in some tight pants, if we took away Hanzo's hammer pants and put him in some, like, jegging, that that would also be sexualized.
He's already sexualized.
I think my favorite part of that, though, was that there was like 11 threads of people telling this person to grow the fuck up, and then a Blizzard employee popped in and was like, you're absolutely right, we'll take this out of the game. Like,
because Jeff Kaplan has no balls.
Yeah, did you not see the entire community telling this person they were wrong, and you felt the need to step in? Like,
oh no, but it was already an internal conversation. It was just, this guy was the tipping point.
Because Jeff Kaplan has no balls. Which I believe he's lead game director on that.
Something like that.
Yeah. Also to point out the fact that if you go and read the entire post about, and it's been parodied to hell and back at this point, the fact that I just want to point out the line about her being 95% spunk. She's British, so you literally just called her 95% jism.
Yeah.
You just referred to Tracer as being 95% semen.
Awesome.
Yep.
That's beautiful.
So that was a thing. Oh, in other news, earlier today, Lou Ferrigno was playing Marvel 3.
What?
Interesting.
Yeah. I saw pictures and posts from this morning, and the Hulk was playing Marvel 3.
Was he playing the Hulk?
I didn't actually get to see footage of him playing, but there were pictures of him, like, on stage playing Marvel 3.
Nice.
I don't know where this was. I don't know why this was, but it happened.
Probably Wizard World St. Louis. Probably because somebody paid him a lot of money to.
Yeah,
yep.
I hear he's a not necessarily a dick, but I've heard stories of, like, because he was in a movie called Bodybuilding with Schwarzenegger, and somebody was like, yeah, you know, that movie was kind of inspirational for me to, like, get in shape and work out more. And instead of actually being like, oh yeah, that's great to hear, he was just like, $20 for an autograph.
Yep.
So I would not be surprised if somebody was like, you know, here's rent for the next 6 months, fucking play this game on stage.
Yep, because that's what Lou Ferrigno does these days. He signs autographs. He goes to every convention and signs all of the autographs because he was the Hulk, like, what, 30 years ago?
Probably
something
more than
like
that.
That.
Yeah. So,
what's the plan for tonight?
Yeah, that was a thing. Play video games?
Yes, but which
I
one?
At some point I at some point when I actually sit down and play the Killer Instinct tutorial. Now that I have a working copy.
Yeah, no.
Also, it's... if Mike hasn't told you, make sure to run the what was it? Performance test?
Yeah. I've already done it twice. I've scored a 1019 out of 1000. So,
yeah, I thought that was kind of interesting that you have to run a test to make sure you can actually play it online.
I really like that, as a matter of fact. Because
I do too.
You don't get people cranking the settings all the way up, running it suboptimally, and they're doing, you know, like, fucking 15 frames a second while you're trying to get 60 frames a second, and it just fucks everything to hell. I mean, doing it on console is completely pointless. You build the game to function on console, but doing it on PC makes a lot of sense just based on the modular nature of it. So yeah, I really like that they did that. I think it was really smart, and I really enjoyed that was a thing. The only thing I ever saw that was almost like a precursor to that was Street Fighter 4 giving your PC a grade that was displayed.
That was just for your connection, wasn't it?
No, it gave you benchmark. It gave everyone's PC a grade based on benchmark. And so you could tell, like, if somebody had an F, there was a good chance that they were trying to play Street Fighter Ultra on a toaster.
Got it. Okay.
So, which was nifty, although occasionally it didn't always understand all of the components. Like, the updates may have been a ways back, based on, like, current technology. So there are certain times where you could run that game at, like, 120 frames per second, but it would still give you, like, a D. So for the most part, like, I just kind of tended to ignore it unless somebody, like, just straight up had, like, an F. I was just like, nope, not playing you.
Yeah.
Although the last time I did play that game was about a month ago, because what was I trying to figure out? Oh, I was testing a stick. I was testing a 360 stick that I had pulled. And this will be a fun story for everybody, because Mad Cat's products both work and don't work. my TE2, my Ultra TE2. Was giving me issues on, like, the first couple of days of Street Fighter V. Basically anything that had to do with the left direction was spotty. So a lot of times I'd go to jump back and I would get neutral jumps. A lot of times I would go to do fireballs in that direction. I'd get, like, DPs or something weird. I was getting super fucking frustrated because I knew that I was garbage, but I knew that I wasn't that bad. I knew that I at least had some mild level of execution to be able to consistently fireball instead of DP. And so I got really frustrated with it, and so Tsaikotyk and I were on Discord talking about it. He's like, well, maybe it's your TPMA, which is the circuit board in the actual joystick component that was bad. It could have been the circuit board, it could have been the Switch. I, to this day, don't actually know. And so, because I own 3 Mad Cat sticks, all stock parts except for a few buttons, which are just different colors of Sanwa OBS F30s, I opened the stick. The TE2 being phenomenal to work on, it just, you push a button, you pop the hood, and you can, everything's laid out in front of you. It's really easy to access. You don't have to, you don't have to even touch a screwdriver. Unless you're, like, trying to take apart the actual joystick. And even then, they include a little mini, like, multi-tool that lets you, that basically will fit with all of the screws on the product.
That's cute.
Yeah, fantastic job on the TE2, but the TPMA was busted. So I pop that out, I go over to my, God, what did I rip it out of? It was the... The TE Round 1. I have, like, an original launch edition TE from when Street Fighter V came out. Which is not easy to work on by any means. Because there is red glue plastered all over everything, and they did all they could in their power to pretty much block anyone from being able to get into the innards, because warranty. Enormous pain in the ass to work on, but at the very least, after ripping a bunch of glue off of shit, the TPMA came out somewhat painlessly. Swapped it out with the one in the TE2, and everything worked fine. I could jump, I could fireball, it was beautiful. So, because I want to shout out, because I want to name drop more companies, went over to Focus Attack, bought a TPMA separately, which I would have got from Arcade Shock, but they were not selling the circuit board separately. So if Arcade Shock ever gets wind of this podcast, sell more parts. I love you guys. Sell more parts. More individual pieces to ship. So went online, bought the TPMA, swapped it back out. And this is a long roundabout story as to why I played Ultra after Street Fighter V. swapped it out, so ended up getting two sticks that worked perfectly fine. At least, I had to test and make sure that I had A, installed the TPMA properly, and B, that it wasn't busted and actually worked. And this was on my round one, so plugged the round one into my computer because it's a 360 stick, and I have a 360 in here somewhere, probably buried under like weird anime figurine boxes. That I don't use anymore, so because it's a 360 stick, plugged it into my computer. The first fighting game that I could think of that I could play somewhat reasonably and actually understand my execution level on was Street Fighter V. So plugged it in, or Street Fighter IV, plugged it in, opened Ultra, immediately went into ranking, immediately found somebody with like 5-bar connection, like perfect connection. Picked Ryu, and I'm an old, like, I mained Chun since 08. But I'd been playing Ryu in 5. Picked Ryu, went up against... Now, I had never played Ryu online before, and I had played maybe like 5 or 6 ranked matches on PC before. So I had like a couple hundred BP, and I went against somebody who had literally never played ranked ever before. Zero PP on their characters, zero BP. Like, no points at all whatsoever. Picked Oni, fucking destroyed them 2 straight rounds. So I was like, I just ruined that guy's experience, but my stick was.
And Nick never had a better night's sleep.
Probably. Let's be completely honest here. That was the first effortless game of Street Fighter 4 I had ever played. So shoutouts to all of that shit. That was a fun experience. Mostly because I received that package early in the morning and then went home for lunch and spent 30 minutes installing shit and then immediately like ran back to work.
Nice.
Yeah, what else is going on in the world recently? What have you guys been up to?
Not a whole bunch.
Tsaikotyk built a new computer and didn't sleep.
Yeah. Got a 5820K as a stopgap processor. Because I'm a complete scumbag.
Just a little.
I didn't feel like it waiting any longer sometimes. For the 6 series processors for the X99.
But they'll be here soon enough.
Yeah, June, roughly. But I wanted to get this beast up and running early, so I did.
Yeah, why wait when you can have it now?
Exactly.
I mean, if you have money.
Yeah. That's the big one.
Well,
I found a new political party that's forming.
Oh,
it's called the Party Party.
The most important party.
Yeah. Yes. Everybody go to thepartyparty.us and you will understand.
Let's be completely honest. Andrew WK would make the best fucking president.
We don't need this law.
I can't argue that.
Is it party?
There is only one law in Andrew WK's America, and that is do what you like and like what you do.
Yep.
Yeah, no, I 100% think that he would actually, with minimal knowledge of politics, would actually make a pretty fucking great president.
Yeah, he's...
Better than the other presidential candidates that have minimal knowledge of politics.
Yeah, it's like, if you watch him on any interview, he's mind-blowing.
Yeah.
With just, like, how knowledgeable about all of this shit he actually is.
And there's a lot of things where, like, I feel like he's being sarcastic or I feel like he's being silly, but I realize that Andrew WK has just ascended to a higher, like, level of awesome. He's become enlightened through partying. Like, it just... It was specifically a, because he does that Ask Andrew WK, like, fan mail column or whatever, and somebody, like, had a question about, like, headbanging. They were like, after I headbang for a long time, like, my neck always hurts. He's like, how do you do it? And it was, like, this soul-searching, like, physically defining journey of how to party and build your neck muscles and like create this euphoria through partying that makes your body no longer feel pain. He's fucking like party Buddha. It's insane. And I'm just like, is this a parody or is this real life? Like, is this all shit that's part of like the Andrew WK mantra? And I'm just like, at this point, I don't know, but I'm going to assume that he is 100% serious all of the time.
Yeah.
He is 100% serious about never being serious.
Those are really good columns.
I think. Yeah. Oh, there's a lot of stuff where he's just like really like insightful and motivating. Like if Andrew WK ever stops making music, that guy will make a career out of motivational speaking.
So he's the positive version of Henry Rollins is what I'm getting out of this.
Yeah. That's a very apt that's a very apt comparison.
Yeah.
At the very least, he might have a better shot at mayor than Jell-O did.
I would say he most definitely does.
Yeah.
Speaking of mayors, Rob Ford died. Not even from the cocaine, Greg. From cancer.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's shocking.
Yeah. Shout outs to Canadian politics for somehow making Marion Barry relevant again in 2015.
Kind of on a more, I guess, more fun, nerdy note. Canada actually declassified all of the Wolverine files. They actually had a page declassified everything about fucking Logan.
What?
Yeah. They had a website where they said they were declassifying Wolverine.
I don't even know what to say or what to think about that. Like, I've had some very unpleasant experiences with Canadians, but that I also really enjoy a lot of people that are very Canadian. So Nathan Fillion near the top of that list. I don't know, man. While I'm staring at video games and thinking about video games and talking about video games, don't buy Dead or Alive Extreme 2. It has less content than don't buy Dead or Alive Extreme 3. It has less content than Dead or Alive Extreme 2 and a lot of the same textures as Dead or Alive Extreme 2.
That makes me sad.
I don't know this from personal experience, but I did read a review on it, which 100% influenced my decision to purchase Senran Kagura Estimal Versus over DOA Extreme 3. So now I get anime titty as opposed to DOA titty, and I'm satisfied that there is actual gameplay involved.
I'm afraid your path ends here.
What's coming out? Oh, Revelator demo is live.
For people in Japan. Which APPSS.
Yeah, that's true. I guess the US Revelator demo is on its way pretty quick.
Tuesday, I believe.
And my understanding is that it's local multiplayer only?
No, it also has like the trials and arcade mode and stuff. They just ask people.
Well, more specifically, there's no online multiplayer.
Correct.
There's no online. They're not trying to stress test servers or anything.
Yeah.
It's like the opposite of a Street Fighter V beta, whereas Street Fighter V went into beta and was like, you can only play ranked online. And this is like, you can't play ranked online, but you can literally do everything else.
You could run tournaments on this. Enjoy.
you could run tournaments on this. You should run tournaments on this. You're running tournaments on this.
Yeah.
When I think of server stress tests, I just think... when Dark Souls 3 was doing theirs, somebody came up with the torch meta.
Oh, that shit was hilarious.
Mike should know this.
The torch meta? What the fuck is the torch meta?
So basically, there was a group of, because all they you could do is basically invasions. You could either be invaded or do invasions for like the first area of the game. And so there were a couple of people that were just standing around, like waving their torches, and they had like four people invade them at one point, and nobody was fighting. They were all just standing in a circle waving their torches, and then it was just like one, two, three, and then they just slaughtered everybody.
Yeah, that show was amazing.
It was really, and the whole thing went on for like 25 minutes of just them getting people to like wave their torches in a circle.
Beautiful.
Yeah, it's like, I love what communities do.
Yep. Speaking of metagames, the and things that I'm legitimately interested in, sort of less so now that America's out, Heroes of the Storm Spring Championships, which is like a, you know how a lot of games do, you know, one giant annual tournament? They're still going to do one at BlizzCon, but they also decided to just pretty much have quarterly global championships. I don't really understand why, but the spring one is down to China and Korea, as if nobody saw that coming.
Shocker.
Yeah, because when it comes to video games, you just always, when it comes to esports, always bet on Korea. Especially during the reign of Street Fighter V. Just put all your money on infiltration every single time.
And good portion
at this
of
at this
four.
Point,
I'm afraid.
But yeah, that worked really well too.
Same thing with
so,
also Korean.
Yeah. I don't know if I'd put all my money on Punko every single time.
Punko,
but if he takes his shirt off,
Punko.
He's definitely.
Yeah, I'm about to say he's. You put your money on Punko for the entertainment value.
You put your money on Punko when he takes his shirt off, then shit gets real.
It doesn't even
especially
matter
if the other guy takes his shirt off first.
That was a good
if
moment.
The other guy takes his shirt off first, definitely bet on Punko.
Yeah, I was just about to say that.
But, no, like, he didn't need to take his shirt off. As long as he's got a character he can gamble with, which is why he's having problems with SF5. But back when
because
he was playing Seth, like...
He has to play Honest?
Yeah. Somebody should tell him to pick up Mika.
Nando should tell him to pick up Mika. Jesus fucking Christ. That man.
Also Marn.
Not expecting any of that. Oh, also the fucking Marn face, dude. The crazy eyes. That was beautiful.
Marn taking off his
shirt
to reveal another shirt underneath.
If you're at all interested in Street Fighter V and haven't been following recently, what tournament was that?
NCR.
NorCal Regionals. Go back and watch NorCal Regionals and just anything that Marn is in. Watch that man destroy. Oh, that was good. I was scared for a while there. I legitimately thought he had a shot at taking it all home.
I did too.
He went through a lot more people in top 8 than I thought he was going to. Like, I thought he was going to make it like past his first match, and then it's just like, oh, he was up against... Fuck, I don't even remember who was like next in top 8. And I was like, oh, well, that's not going to... It was just like, oh shit, well now he's up against... Oh shit, well now he's up against... Okay, he's never beaten Justin before. I think we're safe.
Except he had beaten Justin before twice.
He yeah, but we don't talk about TBC.
Yeah, but one of them was SF4 back in vanilla.
Oh, really?
Yep.
Well, I mean, it was vanilla, so...
Yeah, but
was
this
he
was vanilla
Zagat?
SF5. I don't remember who he was playing back then.
If you have a tournament win and you in Street Fighter 4 vanilla and you were playing Sagat, you're like immediately disqualified.
Well, that's the funny thing is everybody kept talking about how he was the best character in the game, except he never won a major in vanilla.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
I'm so confused. Everything I know is a lie.
It was just like Bison. Everybody was always talking about how good Bison was, even still in SF5. SF5, everybody's like, oh, he's easily, you know, top 3. Nah, hasn't even top 8 at a major yet. Get your head
a major,
fixed.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah.
I was gonna say, I think Moons is on like an NLBC silver medal streak.
Yeah. Oh wait, I guess he did top 8 a major, but not a CPT major. He, Winter Brawl, he top 8'd.
Mm.
But I mean, the character's linear as shit. He doesn't have great options. Like, he wins when you press buttons against him. When you learn not to press buttons against him, he's mediocre. That's always been the case. Except Super Turbo, then he could just cross you up and DOD.
Because Super Turbo is a good game. It teaches you quote-unquote fundamentals.
Yep. Fundamentals, like, don't get fucking touched.
Yep.
Man, this dude's PC sucks. How is he on here? Unless he did the test without, like, streaming, and now he's streaming, but, like, this thing's dropping frames like crazy.
Well, and you and I were also talking about the people that, like, do the stress test, get a passing grade, and then up all their settings.
Yeah.
Oh, that's disgusting.
Right?
You would think that you'd have to stress test after every setting change.
Yeah.
I feel like that's something that hopefully they'll implement.
Yeah, because if you can test on lower settings and then change it, that score is irrelevant at that point.
Yeah, it completely destroys the point of testing.
Yeah. Ooh. Yeah. That's ugly. No, thank you.
So, something I did a week ago that I want to do again, shoutouts to XSeed for localizing and publishing these fantastic, super in-depth, character action brawling style games like Onechan Bara Z2 Chaos and Senran Kagura Estimal Versus. That's only sent with a hint of sarcasm. But no, seriously, $60 for an art book, a soundtrack, and something additional, like...
Yeah, that's huge.
You guys know your fucking player base, and you know the, like, they understand some things about the video games that they localize.
Yeah, and usually that is, like, special edition, $90.
That's what I really love about it, and especially the fact that, like, there are special editions of those games. Like, there's a Senran Kagura special edition for, like, $200 that comes with, like, a docky and a bunch of other crazy shit. Like, but the baseline $60 package comes with a two-disc soundtrack, that I'll probably never listen to, let's be honest. Trading cards and an art book that I've already flipped through a couple of times. So
yeah, and I love what you mentioned about the trading cards too. That's kind of cute.
That they are kind of set. Like trading cards. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I thought that was really clever.
I've got a full set of the Persona ones around here somewhere.
Oh yeah, I've got the
Ultimax,
I've got the tarot cards
and,
too.
What's the other one?
Persona Q.
Yeah.
Honestly, probably the only reason I haven't sold those games. Not that I would have to sell the tarot cards, but at some point, I might want to finish Persona Q. Ultimax is dead to me.
Ultimax is dead to almost everyone in North America.
I don't know, Dacid might still play it.
Well, Arcade's got a version 2 update with a bunch of new stuff that never made it to consoles.
Oh, gross.
Yeah. So a lot of people
that's
stopped
awful.
Playing it because we were like, oh, we'll just wait for version 2, and then it never came.
Yeah. And then Exert happened. Also, to see, like, has CF been, BBCF been released in the US yet?
No, I think next month.
Okay, I was going to say, do we even have an estimate for when CF is coming to the US? Probably somewhere around the release of CF Extend.
Yeah.
Hey. Mendax was asking me how she should ship curlers.
Bubble envelope?
That was a question. Uh-huh.
Bubble envelope?
Yeah, I said bubble envelope with cardboard supports and write "do not bend" on the outside.
which really just
sounds like a
safe
bet.
They'll get bent.
Yeah, right.
Well, you do what you can. Oh, the Hori Pocket Controller. Pretty solid. Good find for $25.
I don't even want one.
Oh,
now.
It's made by Hori?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't realize it was made by Hori. Oh, wow.
That was kind of like a leading factor in one of the reasons I purchased it.
I thought it was
because
just
it was made
some
by someone
like
reputable.
Yeah, I thought when you were describing it, I'm like, oh, okay, it's probably just some third party accessory type thing, but wow, if it's made by Hori, then
yeah, it's not like wow. Nyko Afterglow or anything weird.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. I'm like, all right, well, I mean, if it's only 6 buttons and a D-pad, you mean, you can't fuck that up too badly.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I think I'm like, if I would have heard about that before picking up the Pro Controller, I probably would have done that. But the Pro Controller, I think, is more than enough. Or it's, if you want to play Pocken, like it's a hell of a lot better than using the gamepad.
Where'd he go? What's happening?
What?
Nah.
He's still here.
Oh, wait, there he goes. You said it's and then just trailed off.
That was you.
Oh, well, apparently that was me. Okay.
Because I heard him just fine.
Sorry, guys. Picnic basket. Panic basket. So no, I like the Pro Controller. I wasn't having an issue with it for Pocken, but for $25, I was like, I'll give it a fucking shot.
Yeah, no, and for $25, you can't go too wrong.
Yeah,
like
if
you do want a specialized controller and you've got that, yeah, if I had the $25, I probably would do the same thing. But right now. Yeah, it's not the game now.
Yeah. Also, for the record, anybody who does listen to this, the Hori Pocket Controller, legitimately printed on the underside of the controller, this controller is for use exclusively with Pocket Tournament. It will not function on any other game on the Wii U, so keep that in mind for $25.
Yeah. For a specialized controller, $25 is not that outrageous. And especially from a very reputable company that specializes in controlling.
Yeah. Who've only gotten more reputable as time goes on. Like, I remember Saniti used to use, like, the... It wasn't Tekken Tag 2. What was like, one of the last Tekkens on PS2? Was it, like, Tekken 5?
Yeah.
Yeah. So Saniti had a Tekken 5 stick that he basically had to modify. It functioned as required for a period of time, but he knew the buttons were gonna go. He knew the stick was gonna go. Like it was one of those things. And now, I mean, what is it like the VLXs that they're making and those big ass fucking sticks, the fight sticks that they're making are professional grade. I mean, they work better than Razer Aatroxes, so.
Well, it's not like the A-traps were ever bad, it was just Hori's stock buttons and sticks were bad. But it was like the same thing as the Mad Catz SEs when they first came out, you know?
God, don't even talk to me about the SEs.
Yeah, I was actually going to say Mad Catz as a whole, because I remember back in the day, Mad Catz, they were just the, like, trash controller for any accessory that they made. They were just, like, the bottom of the barrel accessory. But now they're...
Policy. Controller explodes on day 15. That was most Apple devices. That was my experience with Mad Catz in elementary school. There was like a 14-day warranty policy, and by like day 15 or 16, it pretty much just exploded.
Yep. I worked for GameStop way back when, and it was people would come back and just be like, this shit's, you know, broken. Like, we can't do anything about it. I just remember when Mad Catz, they were just trash. But now... they've stepped up their game, and they're really good peripherals.
Yep. Mark Mann saved an entire company. Yeah. It's okay, because the company then turned around and sank itself with that whole Rock Band deal.
Yeah. The old school A-traps. Great sticks, great cases.
trash parts, but now that they're doing the newer A-traps and the BLXs with the Hayabusa and Kuros, they are professional grade. But it's not like their PCBs or anything were bad before.
Yeah, true. Unlike the Street Fighter 4 SEs.
Yeah. Or the WWE Brawl Sticks.
Oh my god, I kind of forget that that's even a thing. I think I intentionally, like, mind wipe myself every time somebody says that.
Anytime somebody John Cena's with the air horn bot.
God, I'm glad we're not in general right now.
I thought about doing it, and then I was like, wait, we're in the wrong channel.
Yeah, this podcast would get a lot less coherent if that bot was able to come in here and scream us. For anybody who doesn't know, if you're a Discord user, go to, or rather, if you run a Discord server, go to airhorn.solution and get that shit working.
I'm assuming there's a lot more you can do with it than just the two you've got, right?
Honestly, I don't think so.
Yeah. Oh, really? It's just for those two
It exists entirely to blow an air horn in your ear and notify you of John Cena's arrival.
I'm still okay with that.
It was an April Fool's joke that I hope never goes away.
Oh, yeah, please, because I hope they expand on that, because it would be pretty fun to, like, just have different sound bites that you could throw in there.
I'm really hoping that they add at least one more, because specifically on Twitter, the Discord Twitter stated that, what was it, like, there was, it was the exclamation point air horn was like the command of courage, exclamation air horn, or exclamation Cena was the command of power, and they were like, the command of wisdom is?
Oh, nice.
I'm like, please give me another one. We need the Triforce of Eerie. We need the Triforce of bullshit sound.
But you should have tried. The only thing I can think of off the top of my head would be the Vuvuzelas.
Oh god.
I don't know, didgeridoos are kind of a bullshit sound too.
That's fair enough.
Still, when your option is a low droning bass noise or pretty much the sound of 1,000 bees, I'm going with the sound of 1,000 bees is more irritating.
Let's ask Nick Cage.
Yeah, boy.
Not the bees.
Ooh, Aria mirrors. Let's do this.
Ooh.
It's Marvel, baby.
When's Marvel?
Right fucking now.
The character has three health bars. The character has three health bars, like in Marvel. Character takes a shitload of damage, like in Marvel. Character has assists and can swap out, like in Marvel. One touch can kill this character, just like in Marvel. Thank you, Keith. Oh, I think Flo had a really good suggestion for Killer Instinct Season 3 features. Every time you finish a match, whether you win or lose, Keith should lecture you on what you should have done differently. It's like at the end of the round, well, what I would have done, because Flo kept forgetting that Instinct was even a mechanic.
Wow.
So he was like, I just need Keats to remind me of that after the end of every match. Like the tips you normally get on loading screens, except they will be written by Keats and based on what you did or didn't do last time.
It'll be fun.
Speaking of which, Blizzard's Battle.net site is so fucking convoluted these days, I didn't even get a good look at what their April Fool's jokes were.
Oh, it was Hearthstone the MMO.
Hearthstone the MMO. We had Maximum Nova Drive was another one of them. Oh, they introduced a new commander in the co-op missions, which was the Carbot Zergling. Yeah, I haven't even really been able to get like a good rundown on them. I know Heroes of the Storm was supposed to have one.
Yeah, I only heard about the Hearthstone MMO.
Yeah.
I didn't hear about any of the other ones.
I thought the Hearthstone MMO was fantastic and altogether disappointing because you know that people would play an MMO of a card game based off of an MMO.
Oh, did you guys hear about the Google April Fool fiasco?
Yes.
I did not.
For Gmail.
What did they do?
They had a send and mic drop button, which would basically send a reply and then unsubscribe you from the thread. But they replaced that with send an archive. So people were hitting that just out of autopilot, and they were unsubscribing from business threads or business chains, and they couldn't get back in.
And it also added a minion mic drop gif.
Yeah, and it added a minion mic drop gif to the email. And people were just like, you know, I've lost business because of this, and I can't get back into these email chains because of it. And it was a fucking debacle.
Fantastic.
I won the Aria.
Oh, yeah. That's right. So we got Diablo. Okay. So of course Warcraft got a ton of things. Void Storage Wars, Cleaved, Project Transmog, Keeping Up with the Barovs, the Ambulatory Undead. They got bullshit patch notes like they always do. What was the Heroes of the Storm one? Explore each pixel of your lane up close to identify the prime movement space. Discover convenient hiding spots. Substantiate the argument that your last game loss was the map's fault. Nexus main view was for use on websites and mobile devices, but the purpose we can only describe as indispensable for Heroes of the Storm players. NLV isn't just available in familiar digital formats in dire need of more zooming. It's also ready to help you leave the physical world behind and zoom towards bold new horizons. Oh yeah, so you could view the lanes in Heroes of the Storm in VR.
Wow.
Diablo made some indispensable merchandise that you could theoretically buy, like the hammer pajamas and the cow portal pillow and the cookbook of Tyrael. We got the Carbot Zergling, and they were looking to release SC2 Balance Manager 2016. Where you pretty much play as David Kim trying to manage SC2.
Wow.
There was Sai was watching. You remember the Nova Vulture minigame?
Yep.
That was in Covert Ops?
Yep.
They made that like a classic arcade style browser game.
Cute.
Called Maximum Nova Drive.
Nice.
The Korean Battle.net got their own set of jokes.
Cute.
Complete with a Blingtron hero for Heroes of the Storm. They introduced vanilla servers complete with original races and long queues. And then Diablo featured special meal plans for each hero. Min-max your food along with your gear.
Adorable. Yeah, the only gaming April Fools that I experienced was in Warframe. And for those of you who don't play Warframe, they have special, like, one-time events called alerts. And they had one. It was a survival, which basically you have to keep activating life support systems, and you can go for as long as you want. And usually alert style missions are a set time, and they're usually like 10 minutes long. This one was a 1 hour survival with enemies of range 60 to 100, and your reward was one credit and a bullshit mod. And people went through it expecting it, oh, ha ha, it's a joke. No, you got one credit and a bullshit mod. There was absolutely no payoff. Like, I got into it thinking the same thing, and the group I was with, we went 45 minutes before we just got obliterated. Because we also had one person leave after, like, 10 minutes. They're like, oh, fuck this, it's an hour long. Like, we tried to actually get through it, but just got overwhelmed. But yeah, people who completed it were like, no, you literally just get one credit and a bullshit mod. And I'm like, that's fucking genius. Because also the title of the alert is the same as what a really good reward is. It's a mod that actually doubles the capacity for your warframes. So instead of getting that, it's a 1 hour long piece of shit for nothing, which I thought was kind of great that they literally gave you nothing at the end of it.
Yeah, that's
true. Like, that's cute, guys. That's fucking cute. And they had this whole big, they call it red text, which is just like the system text. It's like, hey, there's something coming. What is it? It is like this long conversation of just like, oh, it's going to be great. Oh, there's this alert on this planet. It's one credit and an ammo drum. Thanks, Lotus. That's super helpful. And like, it was funny. Like, I got a good kick out of it. I'm glad that it was not some sort of like, oh, we're going to say it's bullshit, but then give you something really cool. Like, no, you just wasted an hour of your time for nothing.
Also, we got the GeForce GTX energy drink from NVIDIA.
What?
Yep, that was a thing. I haven't actually watched the YouTube video on it. It's a 30-second YouTube video. Let me bring it up.
Yeah, that's also what I was thinking the Andrew WK party thing was, because there was a video on YouTube the day before on the 31st. I'm like, oh, okay, maybe this is, but it's like we kind of talked earlier, it's like, is he joking or is he serious? Like, I'm really confused about this.
Yeah.
He's being Andrew WK. It's not meant for us mere mortals to understand.
Yeah.
True fact. Ooh. That's like the second. Oh, ruthless.
Was AMD's able to prove that they're going to be profitable now?
Wow.
Sai, did you see Sean Murray's April Fool's tweet?
No, I didn't.
The official No Man's Sky. Long day coding, but so nice to see the microtransactions finally working.
TB had a ton of good ones, though.
Oh, TB had a ton of good ones.
I thought he wasn't on social media anymore.
I'm pretty sure he sent them through Chris.
Ah.
Yeah, the Total Biscuit account had a ton of good ones. Which I will recite for you.
That's an interesting customization. This orchid has crowbars and a bandana over her face.
That's special.
Interesting.
I can get down with Necromunda Gangster Orchid.
So, Total Biscuit April Fool's tweets included, due to a legal settlement over the Winston video, the channel will produce nothing but Diablo content for the next year. The content will be available exclusively on Sling TV and will require a VR headset to view. Words that were clearly an April Fool's joke from a Total Biscuit account. 30 FPS should be enough for anyone.
Nice.
Also included Kotaku? Don't mind if I Kotadu. Mac Gaming, comma, the future. JonTron did the ISIS, all of it. I was actually in Xbox this whole time. And Total Biscuit buys Gawker Media, immediately regrets decision.
Nice. For those who don't watch, Game Grumps actually did something kind of cute for April Fools. So they just do commentary over the gameplay. They don't do face cam or anything.
Yeah.
and they get a lot of requests for face cam. So what they did is they just reversed it. They only had them on screen while they played.
Good. That's 100% of what I wanted.
It was just them playing the game, if you just watch them talk. And they did three videos. They did two with Skyward Sword, and then Gerard the Completionist and Ross were playing Sonic 2.
Fantastic. You know, they should really go back and give Sonic 06 another shot. I hear that game is solid. One of the few Game Grumps videos I have actually watched. And I think we rage quit somewhere around Silver. I think that was it. Like, the first Silver fight, where if you get touched, you just don't get up anymore.
Yeah.
So, quality content this April Fool's.
Yeah, there was some good stuff.
Our April Fool's joke was nobody did anything.
I still think we should have gone with the April Fool's joke of saying that we're streaming some, like, real big title, but it's just Mike playing solitaire.
That would have worked if I wasn't unconscious.
Well, yeah, and if I hadn't been totally fried, you guys caught what I was saying in the Facebook chat about turning the Twitter account into a Kotaku parody account.
Yeah. That was
I'm saving that one. That's going to happen one of these days. just for the record, if at some point like ZTG ever shuts down or goes off the rails or we just decide it's not worth it anymore, that Twitter handle is turning 100% into a Kotaku parody.
So what you're saying is you're going to do real journalism and put it under the Kotaku name? Is that what I'm getting out of this?
No, I'm going to do less work than Kotaku does. I'm just going to make shitty headlines. I'll make shitty headlines with a picture, and that's it.
I thought that's what Kotaku did.
A picture
already,
I Google image search.
So Kotaku's actually started writing stuff now? Maybe I should go back there.
Shoutouts to also on April Fools, shoutouts to @Sonic_Hedgehog announcing Big Fishing Adventure 3 the trial.
Oh, okay. Fuck you, Game Grumps.
Because we live in a world, in a time, in a place where the official Sonic the Hedgehog account realizes how shitty Sonic the Hedgehog has become. It's that kind of a place.
No, I was just checking my YouTube subscriptions and fucking front and center. Game Grumps, Dark Souls 3. Fuck you, Game Grumps.
At least I unsubscribed to VODcast.
I'm sorry, what?
I said at least I unsubscribed to VODcast, unlike you.
Oh, yeah. No, I should have unsubscribed to VODcast, not because he's not producing content, or he has bad content, but because he's one of those motherfuckers that got Dark Souls 3 early, and I don't want to know anything about it. And it's so tempting to click on those videos, because he does very condensed, more lore-focused type videos, but still, I don't want... Like, the only thing I would want to see is character creation, because I'm always interested in what character creation looks like. Like, to me, knowing what class, starter classes, what their stats are, none of that stuff matters in the whole of things. Like, I like looking at that stuff because I can start thinking, like, how do I want to plan my character? But I don't want to see bosses. I don't want to see lore things, which would be uncovered watching any sort of play.
Yeah, that's why I watched the first 10 minutes of L.I. Joe streaming it when the JP version went live. But he was on PS4, so everything was in Japanese, and he was looking at, like, like this translated image on his phone to figure out what he was doing, so I...
No, God.
I couldn't follow at all, unfortunately. Cinder!
I'm definitely looking forward to that. can't wait for that. It needs to be March. It needs to be March 24th.
We're not in Japan. We're also not getting it on release date. Thanks, Amazon.
Yeah, true.
Rip
you gotta
pieces.
Fuck you, Amazon.
That's what you get for ordering physical copies of video games these days.
Fair point. I mean, otherwise I probably would have just gone to like GameStop or Walmart or something and just picked it up there. But yeah, sometimes there is just that ease of, you know, the digital is nice, but I am kind of a sucker for physical still. Like,
especially
I'm not so opposed to, true. It's like, I'm not completely opposed to digital. I mean, fuck, I have a Steam library that, you know, has more games than I'll probably, yeah, I mean, fuck.
You know, impressively, I think,
254 games in my Steam library.
Impressively, Cupcake Troll's got the smallest Steam library out of us and has the most completion on his Steam library out of all of us.
I was about to say, remember when I first joined you guys, I only had like 65 games in my Steam library.
Shit happens, bro.
Yeah, Humble Bundle happens. Steam sales happen.
I happen.
I think there's probably a good... Yeah, you happen. But I think like a good 30% of my Steam library is Humble Bundle and shit I'm probably not ever really gonna play, like the Tropico games. I have no interest in playing those, but it was in a bundle of shit I wanted. And it was like $6 for everything. So I was like, fuck it. I might as well just spend the $6.
Yeah, so we are making a conscious effort to be more active on social media, which doesn't apply to me because I'm hardly ever fully conscious.
I was going to say, by we, I think Tsaikotyk means I am.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I have not gotten the social media bug ever at all. Like, I used to Facebook, and then I'm just like, what's the point? And stopped using Facebook.
Dude,
I only use
Facebook
for the Messenger.
Yeah. Fuck Facebook, and I'm the one running that shit for ZTG, only because I feel like we should have a presence just because we actually point people in that general direction.
The easier solution is just stop pointing people to the Facebook. Like, we can't get
yeah,
new,
I haven't
new
pointed people
Facebook
to Facebook in a long time.
I know.
The layout
yeah,
looks
I've,
a lot more balanced.
I've just
with
been
two
plugging. Yeah, I've just been plugging, you know, making sure to hit that follow button for Twitch, check us out on YouTube, and follow us on Twitter for a more reliable source of notifications.
Yep. Also trying to do a lot on Twitter now, too. So, and actually engage people and have a presence and not just,
yeah,
you know, notifications.
Yeah, I think also for this might be too personal for you type thing, but, like, there's a lot of times, like, I'll go to say something and I'm just like, who the fuck cares? Like, because I don't. I think that's the
yeah.
problem is that I don't really care, so I think nobody else really fucking cares.
That's 100% of social media, though, is just realizing that nobody cares and saying shit anyway. And then all of a sudden people will care.
And that's how millennials happen. Social justice is a mistake. 2016.
Oh god, what was it that I saw where it was like, nobody's scared of millennial voters, and it was somebody holding a sign saying Trump doesn't feed his Neopets?
That's distinctly awful.
I'm afraid your path ends here. Supreme victory!
Well, if we want to get technical, I guess I've killed more Tamagotchis than Hitler. In fact, I would be surprised if any one of
Wait,
us in
are
this
you...
chat didn't kill as many Tamagotchis as Hitler.
Yep.
I've got like so many scenarios going through my head, but it's just like, because there is that secret Hitler game.
Yeah. No, I'm just... I'm
like,
just...
I was thinking, like, as many Tamagotchis as Hitlers. I'm like, well, there's only one Hitler, so I'm pretty sure most of us can kill more Tamagotchis than...
No. Hitlers. I mean, like, I've killed more Tamagotchis than Hitler did.
Yeah, in terms of people. Yeah. Yeah.
No, so... Just let me go off the rails for a second. This guy I'm playing against on KI right now, his name is Sanico6.
Nice.
bringing it
is
all back to
relevancy. Is he as garbage as his title?
I don't know his plan, Arbiter. We'll find out.
Good shit.
I'm so glad I'm playing KI instead of just putting up a splash image. Otherwise, we wouldn't have had this glorious moment.
That's probably what this podcast is going to devolve into.
I have faced a
glorious moment for me playing KI.
I will quell you playing KI. And douse your friends. Has anybody else even tried Alex?
No.
No. I haven't turned on SF5 since the last time we played.
Okay, so for the record, Air Stampede exists solely for the sake of playing Leapfrog. Like, that move has virtually no other applicability. And like, Ultra and Sanchez were talking about it on Twitter last night. That move has like 55 frames of recovery and like 20 something of startup. It's god awful. And
hell?
It doesn't cross up. It does not cross up. It is physically incapable of crossing.
Weird.
So yeah, Air Stampede is terrible. And Sanchez found the only use for it is to use the heavy version to get out of the corner. Pretty much to intentionally miss with it to get out of the corner. It's bad. Most of his moves have awful unarmored like startup, except for the light versions. I was not finding use. I mean, granted, I was playing Sanidi's Karin, so I was just getting my shit pushed in. But yeah, trying to use a flash chop that wasn't light was not gonna start up in any reasonable amount of time that it took them to jump in and kick me in the face. God, what else? Elbow didn't seem particularly useful. I didn't get a hang of being able to V trigger and use the clothesline, so that was disappointing. And I didn't look far enough into it to get head crush, but so all in all, seems like gimmicks. Maybe, but I was really, really, really struggling. So that happened. I'm really waiting on, like, I'm really curious if we're gonna get a pocket patch anytime soon. Like, is Nintendo aware of this block string infinite? Are they gonna try and do anything about it? Do they really give a fuck? Are they just like, it's a fighting game, or it's a casual fighting game for casual fighting gamers?
Wait, what is this?
Oh, Shadow Mewtwo.
Shadow Mewtwo has a block string.
Adorable.
Yeah, if you do the pillar and then you EX it on hit and you block it, you get enough time to get another pillar out and hit and EX it again. EXing it eats Mewtwo's health, but because of the way, and you can't win by chip damage, but because of the way that Pocken calculates health based on percentage and not by numbers, Mewtwo will always win because one health is a greater percentage for him than literally anyone else, because Shadow Mewtwo has the absolute lowest health in the game.
Interesting.
So you will put yourself
Mewtwo more health. You can launch your infinite all you want, but you're gonna lose games.
Yeah, that sounds like something Nintendo would do. The other issue, the key issue with the block string infinite is it wouldn't be as much of an issue is if it would just guard break. It does not guard break. It is physically incapable of guard breaking. It'll put you all the way down into like the lowest red, but it will not guard crush you.
Awkward.
So, the other solution as somebody playing against that in the current patch is just get hit by it. Because it's not an infinite if you get hit by it. Yeah, you'll take a shitload of damage, but at least you won't lose,
right.
Theoretically.
Huh, interesting.
So, yeah, it's a bit of a problem child. I'd like to see it patched out, but it doesn't appear that like there are enough people playing. There, it doesn't appear to be enough people abusing it on rank right now that it's that much of an issue.
An issue, yeah. I think that's the biggest problem is that it has to be an issue.
Yeah. So
I'm gonna pose a question to you guys.
Yeah.
It might be a little harder for Mike since he's preoccupied, but maybe he has something already in mind. Because I've been looking through my Steam library. You know, we all have a lot of games on our Steam library. Is there any game on there that you guys want to play but you feel you'll never get around to?
On my own personal Steam library?
Yeah.
Oh, that is a fantastically interesting question.
Are we talking play or finish?
Ooh, also a very good specification.
You know what? Whatever you feel is more relevant.
I'm gonna go with Wasteland 2, because as much as I love old school RPGs, I think there's no way in hell I'm ever going to get to finish that game. I don't have enough time.
Games that I would like to finish, Gianna Sisters Twisted Dreams and Jet Set Radio. Games that I have never even started, that I do not think that I will, that I would like to at some point. I got almost 400 games. This might take me a little while.
All right. Well, while you're doing that, another I'll fill victory, in. For yes, me, it would be the Sean Cake. There is always another
battle. Fair.
They look really fun. They're sort of old school, sort of action platformers. But I just have so many other games that I also want to play. I'm always like, oh hey, you know, I'm not playing anything. I'll play Shantae, and then it's like, ooh, wait, something else. And it's like I've got both.
You know, it wouldn't be so much of a problem if that something else wasn't usually Warframe.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know, like, it's like, I've actually started up the Shantae's Risky's Revenge Director's Cut. I played maybe, actually does, even though it's uninstalled, actually I have played 100 minutes of it, awkwardly enough. But it was just something I never got back to. And it's like, I want to, because from what I played, it was fun, and it was a little different in terms of how you navigate, because it's not just straight left to right. Like, you do actually go back and forth through layers of stuff, which was kind of interesting. But yeah, it's a game that I actually had some fun with that I just never have fucking gone back to. And it's one of those games that I feel that is probably so... Actually, the last time I played it was a year ago. Almost to the day. Last played was 4/11/2015. Yeah, it's like, you know, Warframe has taken over because it's... Even though that it's essentially something that I hate doing, which is grinding and RNG, there's something about it that keeps it fun for me, and I can't... place why.
So I think I found a couple of games that I will probably never even start up that I would like to at some point like finish. First, Homeworld Remastered. I want to play Homeworld. I'd like to finish Homeworld, but fundamentally every time I look at that game I'm just gonna say, why not just play StarCraft? And the thing that has led me to get to that point was I tried playing Gregu, and it was terrible. And at this point, I'm like, there are only two RTSs. There are only three RTSs that exist in the world, and two of them are in the same franchise. Brood War, SC2, CNC Red Alert 2.
I like CNC 3 more.
The actual Command and Conquer 3?
Yeah.
Another victory. I never touched it. I played CNC 1, I played Tiberian Sun and Firestorm, I played Red Alert 2 and Yuri's Revenge, and I played maybe 15 minutes of Red Alert 3 and was like, God, this is awful. Oh, and I played Generals and General Zero out.
And those were both awful.
Generals was interesting.
I had fun with Generals. I don't know if I would necessarily say that it was a good game, but I had fun with it because I had people to play
with. I'll agree with that. It was fun, but it wasn't great.
Yeah.
Yeah. No. I would wholeheartedly agree with Red Alert 2. I fucking had a blast with that game.
Red Alert 2 was so good.
Yeah.
And it's like I miss that. I mean, I know they've still continued it with some of the other Command and Conquer games, but just that sort of B-movie cinematics between missions and all of that stuff. Like, that was so fun about that series.
Yeah.
And I think that's kind of what turned me off of Generals, because it was almost too straight.
Mm-hmm. The original Generals was really hard to get around. Was really hard to, like, wrap your head around because it didn't lend itself to the name. You had USA, China, GLA, and I think that was it, right? You had
three factions. That was good.
Yeah, you had USA, China, and GLA, and that was like it. It was like having Soviet allies and Yuri, but not... Something about it didn't feel right. And everything, yeah, felt a little too real and a little too bland. Generals spiced it up a lot. Because you got at least two, I think maybe even three generals for every faction. Like, you actually had generals. You weren't just, like, a faceless thing. And so each faction then got almost kind of sub-faction. And so, like, the U.S. Air General got all these crazy upgrades that you never saw before. The U.S. late, like, Super Weapon General got to use the ion cannon way more frequently. The China Infantry General basically just forewent tanks and built a bunch, like, built Zerglings with miniguns. The GLA, like, Scud missile, or the GLA bioweapons general was almost like a hard counter to China. It was just like all of your infantry are dead because there's just smallpox everywhere. So.
Yeah.
It made playing the individual factions a lot more fun, and it added a lot more upgrades and unique things that you could actually do, and I was like, oh, this is actually cool.
You know what other
but
game
like I said,
is,
I
Company of Heroes 2.
I have those. I've never been super interested, and I will probably, let's be honest, never get around to it. Oh, back to Cupcake Troll's thing. Yes, I want to play Ori and the Blind Forest, but I will probably never boot that up. I was like all super excited when I saw the trailer at, I think, E3, and then it came out on PC, and I was like, oh, this game looks super cool, and then I bought it, and then I installed it, and then I never opened it. Let's see. I will probably never see the end of Quake 2, or Quake 1.
But those games are so short.
Yeah. Okay. Not for lack of trying, but I will also probably never see the end of Doom 1. Because I'm bad.
You could always get good.
Yeah, but that takes time that I don't really have.
I'm just saying, you're in a call with two Souls players. We don't want to hear about how anything's too hard.
Yeah.
I'm just remembering back to when you were playing Bloodborne and you were asking about skill, and I'm like, yeah, put all your points into skill. It helps you get good.
Yep. Okay, are there any games that you guys have purchased on Steam that you regret?
Several.
Oh, yeah. I streamed one of them.
Which one was that?
Wolfie?
Ah!
I thought you were going to say Dandelion, but okay.
Oh, that episodic game that got shit canned after the first one.
Yeah. And I apparently misread stuff, and I didn't realize it was supposed to be an episodic game. And I'm like, oh, you know, I'm a big sucker for, like, Twisted Fairy Tale. This sounds like it might be up right up my alley. And I get to the end, and it was like, wait a minute. I just read that the studio's closing, and it's to be continued. What the actual fuck?
MKX.
But yeah, that's, like, the big one.
What was that, Sai?
MKX. Shoutouts to not getting Season 2, or the improved netcode, or, you know, anything.
Yeah.
Literally anything. That was a hot fucking disaster. Complete blow-up.
Yeah, I wouldn't say Dandelion I regret. I just... It was weird. Like, cause it was 14 hours of just, like, mediocre, and then it's like, I see what they were trying to do at the end, but it just fell flat. It was like, you were almost there. I'm just trying to think, is there anything else? Well, it's kind of in the same vein, but it would be something that, I bought, like, I don't regret buying it, I regret streaming it. And that was the beginner's guide.
That's the name of a video game?
Yeah, it was done by the same guy who did Stanley Parable, and I read a lot saying, oh, it's not... Don't expect the Stanley Parable. It's not the same as Stanley Parable. So I'm like, all right, cool. So, you know, it might not be super comedic. It might be something different. But it just became something, like, it became awkward to play because it was like, it was this whole thing where you were playing games that this guy's friend made. And it became like this weird apology letter in the end. And it was like, ooh. That was very, like, I wouldn't have been so, like, embarrassed by it if I had just played it.
Okay.
Like, privately. But streaming it, like, I just felt awkward to stream that because it wasn't a stream game.
Okay.
It was more of a private experience game.
That's fair. Things that I regret purchasing on Steam. Yanagarasu Attack on Cataclysm.
I like that game, though.
What's that?
I said I like that game, though.
It's not that I didn't like the game. The gameplay was okay. I regret paying money for what feels like it was an unfinished product that was advertised as a finished product, and I don't think will ever actually feel like a finished product. That game, to me, feels like it's in perpetual alpha. Finish wise, balance and mechanic wise, I don't necessarily think so, but in terms of visual flavor and representation and screen transitions and a lot of the actual mechanics that they were trying to, or not mechanics, but a lot of the actual, like, polish that they were trying to implement never actually came to fruition. Like, I feel like the game still functions 90% of its menus on Helvetica font. Which just does not have polish to me. Like, if you are using, like, default internet fonts, come on. A little bit more effort, please. I understand that it was an indie game, but I played a lot more indie games that felt a lot more dumb.
Fair enough.
Lethal League finish feels more finish than Yanagarasu Attack on Cataclysm.
Well, I've actually got another one I could say I could say regret buying. And this might be a controversial one. Except Skyrim.
Yeah.
I actually wanted to like Skyrim, but I cannot get more than like 15 minutes into the game before I'm done. I'm just like, I can't get into that game.
Yeah, in retrospect, Skyrim was a waste of money for me as well. Starbound.
Was that the Terraria spinoff?
Yeah, that was like the Space Terraria.
That's also
never got
to
into
finished.
Those games.
Yep. That game is also in perpetual alpha.
Oh.
Let's see.
Let's briefly go back to games coming out that we're interested in. Honey Cam Studio.
Okay.
I almost forgot that's coming out
next week. Yep.
Okay. Yep. Yeah, and I've actually got one for 3DS that's coming out the end of the month. Bravely Second End Lair.
Oh, I know a lot of people were super hyped for that. I didn't play Bravely Default, so...
Bravely Default was super fun. It had a lot of stuff that I liked about it. It did have a little bit of, like, an old-school, like, FF feel with the job system and how you could take certain skills from other jobs you had leveled up and stuff. One of the things that I really did like about it, and it's mainly because I'm lazy, is that there was a way to auto grind in that game.
No.
They had the ability to where you could set up like a list of moves, like, okay, I'm gonna have this person attack, I'm gonna have this person cast fire, I'm gonna have this person attack and this person attack, and then you just like hit the auto button and it just repeats those actions. So it was just like, okay, cool, so I'm sitting in this course that I'm taking and we're watching fucking like YouTube videos and a slideshow, and I'm just in a dungeon moving the stick around to get my characters to move. I crank the encounter rate up by 100%, so I'm just constantly getting into battles, and then I would just check every now and then to make sure a character hasn't died, and then I just go back to doing that. So basically while I'm in class I'm leveling up my characters, and when I get home I just play.
I'm vaguely reminded of, what was it, pressing the Y button in Persona? P3 and P4? Or, I'm sorry, not a Y button. Wow, that controller doesn't even have a fucking Y button.
Yeah, that's why I didn't say anything.
Triangle.
Yeah.
Pressing triangle in Persona 3 and 4, which put the battle on autopilot, and everybody moved and attacked, like, just basic attack, really fucking fast. It just speed ran the battle by basically holding down the attack button.
Mm.
Except all you did was press triangle, and it put everybody on auto run and attack.
Interesting.
So anything that legitimately wasn't challenging or didn't have physical resistances just got bodied.
Yeah.
Of course, at the very least, that game did give you the option to avoid encounters.
Yeah, Bravely did the same thing. Like, you could crank it to plus 100, and then you could take it down to zero.
Yeah.
Or minus 100.
Yeah, the Persona games, they had the, like, roaming enemies that you had to, like, run into and attack, almost kind of like Neptunia, that kind of thing.
And Earthbound.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Best RPG ever.
Shoutouts to a game I'll never play.
There's a lot of games that did that.
Okay, so here's a game that almost kind of fits like the whole spectrum. I kind of regret purchasing it, except I don't really now that I remember how I bought it. but I'd like to finish it. Like, I want to play it and I want to finish it, but I don't think I will ever actually get around to. And specifically because I said I regret purchasing it and then I realized how much I paid for it, and now I don't anymore. Tsaikotyk remembers this game. Get Out of Hell.
Oh. It's pretty good.
I never fired that game up.
After you yelled at me for missing out on the $5 deal.
Yep.
I think another game that I would like to actually play, which I don't think I will, was a game that I played a little bit on the original Xbox, which was Sudeki. It's kind of like an action RPG style game where you
kind of
between...
sound familiar, yeah.
Yeah, you switch between a couple of different people and you have like your melee combat character, your ranged combat character, your sort of magic caster character. Which I also love that Steam will also remind you of when you purchased games.
Yep.
Because that was also a year ago that I purchased that. Haven't installed.
I'm trying to remember. Okay, yeah, that was the name of the game. Did this ever actually get released? Yes, it did, to fucking horrendous reviews. Holy crap. Actually, very mediocre reviews. Can we bring Crimson Dragon to the PC, please?
Can we get Jade Cocoon?
Jade Cocoon. Why does that sound super familiar?
Jade Cocoon is another one that sounds really good. Crimson Dragon, looking at it, does not ring a bell.
It's a spiritual successor to the Panzer Dragoon series.
Jade Cocoon was basically like Serious Pokemon on the PS1.
Yeah, I remember seeing it, never played it.
Yeah, I'm looking at Jade Cocoon now, and it's bringing back, it's kind of calling back a little bit. I didn't ever play it, but
that game was hella good.
But
can we extend the games we regret buying to games we regret spending money on?
Sure, if you want to go that route.
More or less the same thing.
Shoutouts to Paladins.
I don't know.
You were lit as
day.
You were turnt as fuck.
Yeah,
that
was
a glorious day.
That was half a fifth of tequila and me having too much money and going, "Fuck this pay-to-win game. I want to win."
Yep.
Oh, I was glad to have been a part of that.
Also, games we regret spending money on, in literally any capacity, Colonial Marines. Doesn't matter how much money you spent on it, Colonial Marines.
We don't talk about that game at all.
This is a happy place. I bought the first Askreed. Like, why did I buy Askreed?
Yeah, I did the same thing. I didn't finish it because it was super, super repetitive. And it was just like, okay, so I need to do this, I need to do that, and I need to do this other thing. And then everything you needed to do followed that order before you got to your assassination.
Yeah.
It was just like, well, I'm bored and screw the Askreed games. And everybody was telling me like, oh, that's a huge mistake. Like, what, like, read the summary of the story for one and then just start on two. Like, yeah, I'm done with that as a whole. I'm good,
yeah.
Thank you.
The first one is the worst. I don't think they're necessarily good games, but they are fun to fuck around in. They're like if I've got free time and I'm bored as shit, I will fire up one of them.
Other games that I regret spending money on, Bioshock 2 and Bioshock Infinite.
Good call.
I didn't mind them. I'm in the, like, I enjoyed my time with them, but I'm not going to say that they were great games.
Yeah. I spent money on them because I could get, like, all three of them for less than the price of, like, Bioshock 1.
Nah, fair point.
So, but I will never play 2, and I have very controversial opinions on Bioshock Infinite.
Yeah, it was, like I said, I enjoyed my time with it. I thought the Burylit Sea DLC was better, but it didn't make it worth picking up.
Games that I do not regret spending money on three separate times include Devil May Cry 4 and Bulletstorm. I have never regretted spending money on Bulletstorm.
All right, that actually gives me another question. Is there any game that you will, like, defend to the death that is generally viewed as a bad game?
Max Payne 2.
Generally viewed as a bad, like, just a legitimate, like, this game is shit, and I'm like, no, this game is amazing, or games that I'm just like, yeah, you're right, that game is shit, but I really fucking love it.
That's actually a really good counter question.
Because Wet is a shit game, but it's fun.
I think I'm more looking for a game where it's like somebody is like, it's a bad game and you should feel bad, and you're like, no, I fucking love this game.
Okay. Let's see. Let me try and find something that's like not super controversial. stare at my wall over here for a minute. Of titles. Um, I have a lot of niche titles that aren't necessarily like heralded as bad games. They're just games that like nobody played. No More Heroes.
That's a good game.
Yeah, one and two. They're both good games, but like, how many people actually played them?
Yeah, but having nobody play them is different than somebody saying it's a bad game.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. I'm like, I can't say that people like it's heralded as a bad game because nobody really played it, and the people that did play it liked it.
SFXT. that had the same problem. That game was killed by the stream monsters. Nope.
Yeah.
I guess while you're going, I'm going to say, like, and it's kind, this one's kind of hard because since it is a series, there are some games that people are like, no, it's really good. And then there's like that one game that everybody is like, no, it's bad. I'm just going to say Mass Effect as a whole. Like, I don't regret any, like, I understand, like, I see where people are coming from when they're talking about 3 and I get it, but I still enjoyed it. I still liked it.
That's 100% of where I was going to go before I said, let me start with something less controversial, was Mass Effect 3. Mass Effect 3, I felt like, was a good game. Obviously, everybody's like, oh, a Star Child ending. Yeah, it was bullshit, and it was stupid, and everybody hates it. Even the people that love that game hate it.
Yeah.
But fundamentally, from the game standpoint, and this is specifically because of the group of people I'm talking with, because I know Tsaikotyk fucking hates, like, everything after the first one, because
I like
of Sticky
two.
Cover. Okay.
Two's cover wasn't as bad as
I know you very... I know you very specifically hate 3's Sticky Cover.
I've never even finished it. I haven't gotten to the controversy about the ending because I'm too busy being embroiled in controversy about Sticky Cover.
Yeah. So, in fact, personally, I felt like mechanically, the level ups and the systems that were in place in that game were the best hybrid blend of RPG and shooter. I felt like Mass Effect 1 was an RPG with bad shooter combat. I felt like Mass Effect 2 was a shooter with vague concepts of RPG mechanics in it. I felt like Mass Effect 3 was the best blend of both worlds that they did.
Yeah, and that's kind of how I feel too. It's like, when I got to the end, it was kind of like, oh, well, this is a little disappointing that everything up until now kind of didn't really actually matter. And I'm basically just choosing, you know, a color ending. But yep. I personally didn't allow that to take away from everything else that I experienced in the game. Like, I will admit wholeheartedly, Morden. That scene stopped me.
Have you...
Like,
okay.
I needed a minute after that.
As much as we love to hate them, have you watched the Heyash on Mass Effect 3?
No.
I don't remember. I might have to go back, because it's been a while since I've actually...
It came out within the last couple of months. It came out within the last couple
of... No, I stopped watching them like a year.
Ash goes to Anthony and she's like, Anthony, what's wrong? Like, there's water coming out of my eyeballs and I don't understand. Am I gonna die? And he's like, what's happening? And she takes him back out in the living room and she points to the screen and it's the scene just after Morden. And he goes, oh, you're at the part where Morden died. Yeah, like, that's a really emotional scene, but I didn't think it would affect you. And she's like still crying and she thinks she's gonna die. And then from then on, it just goes on this tangent about how, you know, if faced with a moral decision, who would you trust, Anthony or Ash? And like everybody in the family is like, Ash, like no questions about it. And then at the end, Papa Birch tells him he should kill himself and then he hangs himself. So the punchline from the incredibly politically correct trigger warning Birch family is that Anthony hangs himself. So I don't even know what to think about that series anymore at this point, except for the fact that fuck them because their indie game film festival whatever thing was how Undertale was the write-in candidate and won president of 2016. So fuck you, and fuck you. Games, so back on that list, games that people tend to believe are bullshit, that I will pretty much defend to the death. Devil May Cry 4 gets a lot of hate because it was rushed. It reuses literally every area of that game gets used twice, or virtually every area of that game gets used twice, which cut the tile sets in half, and you fight every boss almost three times. So, yeah, I see where people are coming from. Nobody plays Devil May Cry for the story. Like, all of the stories are pretty fucking hacky. Like, DMC1's story was, we have to stop Mundus. That was the start and end of the story. Like, we have to stop Mundus. And then you went to an isle, or you went to an island, and you fought a bunch of shit, and you stopped Mundus. Like, there was, oh, Trish is good, but she's evil, but she's good. Like, okay, There was the part where she attacked you, and then there was the part where you were friends, and then there was the part where she attacked you again, and then there was the part where you were friends by the end. Like, that was the entirety of character development on Trick. And Dante, for that matter. We don't talk about DMC2. DMC3 was Virgil is trying to bring hell to Earth, I think. I think that was the story in DMC3. There was this tower, and Arkham and Virgil were, like, trying to unleash demons on Earth, and Dante really just wanted to have a party, but they brought demons around, and the demons kind of fucked up his shop, so he had to come stop his brother. And then it turns out that Arkham was more evil than Virgil was, and so you had to stop Arkham, and then you had to stop Virgil because, reasons. DMC4... Yeah, as I've made very abundantly clear, like, the Devil May Cry story is not the reason that anybody plays the game. Johnny Young Bosch does kind of slightly taint the credibility a little bit, but...
Oh, why does that mean after, familiar?
Think of an angsty teenager with a big sword in an anime that you've watched, and JYB probably voiced it. Black Ranger from, I think, Season 2 of Power Rangers...
That's why it sounds familiar. Got it.
Johnny Young Bosch kind of puts a little taint on it. Most notably, he's Ichigo from the English dub of Bleach. And the Black Ranger. But at this point, the three main cast members of Devil May Cry, being Nero, Virgil, and Dante, have all worked on Power Rangers. Like...
Adorable.
I forget the name of the guy that voices Virgil, but he was a Blue Ranger in some version of Power Rangers. And Ruben Langdon has not actually acted in any Power Rangers, but he lives and works in Japan as a Sentai stuntman. So he has done stunts for the Japanese Power Rangers that get imported into America.
Nice.
And he's Dante's VA for 3 and 4. And 5, if that ever actually does legitimately happen, because there have been pictures of people in mocap suits for that, for something that is hopefully that. So anyways, the reason people hate Devil May Cry, reuse of areas, reuse of bosses excessively. Devil May Cry 3 had a bit of a boss rush at the end, but that was only the second time you fought any of those bosses. And it's kind of an optional boss rush, too. My understanding is you basically have to build a triangle, and so you can kind of fight any three bosses that will assemble a triangle. So I think the speedrun fights Agni and Rudra again, fights Cerberus again, and fights Beowulf again. But you can fight Nevin again. You can fight pretty much any of the other bosses again. You fight Virgil 3 times, but you kind of tend to fight Virgil 3 times in every DMC. Except for 4, where he literally does not exist until Special Edition is a playable character. But DMC1, you fought him 3 times. I don't think he exists in DMC2, which doesn't exist. He's what?
He does not exist in DMC2.
Okay. But yeah, you fight him 3 times in DMC1 and 3 times in DMC3, which I think is kind of funny. but what really does it for me is the combat has so much polish and so many options. Dante has style switcher from the get-go. You don't have to be playing on PC with a mod. Nero's combat, the one kind of taint on the combat is everything feels like it was scaled for Nero, and so Dante just gets fucking imba when you get to play him as a character, because like all of the enemies' abilities and attacks and shit are all kind of scaled for Nero, how fast Nero moves, what Nero can do, and how tall he is.
Death comes to all.
You can pretty much get like an almost flawless Agnes 2 with Dante, because all of Agnes 2's basic attacks are scaled for Nero's hitbox, and Dante ducks. He low profiles most of Agnes's moves. So that's kind of an interesting side effect of how rushed that game was. But the combat is so fucking flawless. Like, I love that game to death, and I will defend that game to death. It feels so good to have in your hands.
Yeah, it's funny because you had brought up the whole story thing. Like, I view beat-em-ups like that like I do porn. I'm not there for the story. Like, if I want to play a beat-em-up, I want to just rain death upon giant groups of enemies. I don't really care what the story is.
On that note, I have two questions for you. Number one, do you have Devil May Cry 4 Special Edition? Because if that's your mentality, you will love the fuck out of Virgil. You will love the fuck out of Virgil. He is OP as shit. Multiple times, I've had like DMC players say that he does too much damage too fast. He kills things too fast. I didn't think it was possible to kill shit too fast in a speedrun. But I've had Private Cinnamon Bun, who's speedrun the shit out of Virgil in DMC 4 SE, say that Virgil kills things too fast. So, yeah, so if that's your mentality, DMC4 SE Virgil would be a really good trip for you. Also, if you just want to beat the fuck out of a bunch of things and be visually engaged in it, you should also probably pick up Senran Kagura S Devil Versus.
You know what? I was watching you play it, and I'm like, I could get behind this because it's not necessarily Dynasty Warriors-esque, but yeah, I mean, it's just a massive beat-em-up in a relatively big area. And I'm like, okay. And then it was just like, we got into all those VN parts. And, this is really killing. But, you know, if you're playing it privately, you know, you really want, you can just skip all that shit. I mean, also tend to view myself more as a story versus gameplay. Like, I prefer story. Like, if it's got a good story, I can forgive, you know, mediocre, repetitive gameplay. But when it comes to a beat-em-up style game, like, as long as you have the thinnest of premise of a story, like we have to stop person. Cool. I'm just annihilating hordes of enemies because I need to stop someone. That is enough motivation for me. But if I'm playing, like, an RPG or something that's a little more, you know, supposed to be story driven, like, you know, I prefer a good story over gameplay. Like, I can forgive mediocre gameplay for a good story, but so just beat-em-ups are that exception. Like, I can forgive mediocre story for good beat-em-up.
So the thing about Senran Kagura is that the story is 100% like a joke. It's like pretty much like watching comedy anime filler almost. There's virtually nothing serious about it, especially once we got to like the slippery shinobi summer sports thing, where it was just where, oh well, we're gonna play a mini game where you eat underwear, or we're gonna play, you know, a mini game where you touch poop, or we're gonna play a mini game where you and the best part was you split butts, and then everybody realized that their butt was already split, so it was like, okay, well now we're gonna play a mini game where you touch butts. None of those were actual mini games that you played within the theme of gameplay, but that was just like the little story snippet. Like, it was 100% just like full-blown joke. And yeah, there are probably characters that have some backstory, but Estival Versus feels like it was branded and built and conceptualized as the beach episode of the Senran Kagura series. So that's about where I am with that. Like, Shinobi Versus has a little bit more character backstory. There's some things that you can do. You can learn about these people and where they are and why they are. So, and that's the Vita exclusive one. But this feels 100% like it's a beach episode.
Nice. And I, again, like, you know, I would not forgive Danganronpa if it had a bad story. Because as fun as the trial segments were, that's not enough to carry the game. Like, it needed that story. But because, you know, like, something with Sengen Kagura, Bayonetta, Devil May Cry, like, the primary purpose of me wanting to play those games is for the combat.
So, you and I are almost the polar opposites on that, in that respect. If gameplay is mediocre and the story is not outstanding, I will throw it away. I feel like if you gave me Mass Effect 1 now, I would play it through for the story. Back when I first got the game, I was like, wow, the gameplay is really kind of fun, and the story is really good. If you gave it to me now, I would grind through it to get to the end of the story.
Okay.
Because the story has to be spectacular, or I have to feel like it's really fucking good to carry mediocre gameplay. I will play a game with the literally worst story in the world if I feel like the gameplay is fun.
Yeah, fair enough.
Like, and it's really hard for me sometimes, because sometimes I can kind of get into certain kind of gameplays, and other times, like, it's basically the reason I can't be carried by a turn-based RPG. Like, it doesn't matter how fucking good the story is in a turn-based RPG, I will lose it over random encounters and grinding and non-story related battles.
Fair enough.
Because the mechanics are so boring to me. Final Fantasy 13 almost carried me through to a certain point, but let's face it, that was a long walk down a shiny hallway to a boss fight.
Yeah.
Even the boss fight was press X for auto combo.
Yeah, like, I liked what they were trying to do with the combat system. I felt that it was different enough to be interesting, but just the game as a whole, like, I think I got to the point where you were done with the hallway segment, and you were actually into the more open area aspect of the game, and I just lost all interest at that point. I'm like, I'm done.
Which is,
and I'm glad I didn't invest more time into the 13 series, because I hear that it just went to fucking hell.
Which is funny, because I think you were pretty much at the end. I feel like Final Fantasy 13 opens up, like, right before it closes.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Like, I feel like that was one of the major complaints.
Oh, weird.
But, yeah, like, Mass Effect 2 and 3, I was totally okay with the gameplay on. Pretty much any beat-em-up that I've played, especially because I tend to prefer spectacle fighters to Dynasty Warriors style games. Every once in a while if you get something like Senran Kagura where I can rack up like a fucking 1,000 hit combo, like, it feels kind of fun. If I can kill 15 guys at a time in a Dynasty Warriors, like, way more fun than having to pummel the one guy, or pummel, you know, one or two guys, and then turn around and kill the other ones. Like,
right.
If I feel like I'm killing a lot of people at a time, it's way more entertaining than, you know, slowly having to kill two or three people in that style game. However, Bayonetta, Devil May Cry, a little bit different, a lot more involved, a lot more stylish.
Yeah, then the combat system is a lot more involved with those types of games than a Dynasty Warriors-esque.
Yeah. Predominantly, I feel like, because most of the enemies in spectacle fighters or character action games, whatever you want to call them, don't tend to have a whole lot of hit stun. Or tend to be a lot more proactive. Because in Dynasty Warriors or Senran Kagura or whatever, your garden variety enemies will pretty much stand there and wait to get comboed. In Bayonetta and Devil May Cry, they will actively attack you, and if one of them is being hit, the others will also try to, like, actively attack you.
Yeah. Right.
So you have to actually pay attention. Bosses pretty much don't have any hit stun outside of specifically vulnerable periods. So you can combo and attack a boss, sure, but if you don't dodge the incoming fireball, your combo is gone and you're going to eat a ton of health and damage.
Yeah.
So brief side note back from Spectacle Fighter Land, where we've been spending some time, back to games we would defend to the death. Resident Evil 6. It was.
I'm sorry, you broke up there a little bit. What?
Resident Evil 6. It was basically
Resident Evil 6. I'm barely able to make that out over the tin can.
Oh. Yeah, same here.
Huh. I wonder if it's my connection, though.
And now you sound good.
Oh. Well, anyway, it was mechanically superior to 5, which everyone loved the shit out of. The AI was better, so as a solo player, that makes a huge fucking world of difference. But no, everyone shit on 6. And I can understand why from, like, a story perspective, because the story wasn't all that great, and Wesker was gone, but it's not like 5 had a fucking, you know, Oscar-winning screenplay, either.
Right.
I have one thing to say about Resident Evil 5, and that is Shiva. It was fully upgraded sniper rifle that'll pretty much one-shot anything. Cool. I stick that in my backpack and use this level 1 pistol. God damn it, woman!
Yeah. Yeah, I couldn't get into the Resident Evil games until 4. And then 4 was the last one I played. Like, I thoroughly enjoyed my time with it. I think because they changed it from the, you know, it wasn't tank controlled, it was more of a third person shooter.
They changed it from fundamentally being Resident Evil into being a third person shooter.
Yeah, and that just meant better with me than the other Resident Evil games. I just couldn't get into them. Like, my biggest memory of Resident Evil was, I think when Resident Evil 1 had been out for a while, and I'd gone over to a friend's house, and I was like, oh, what are you playing? Oh, I'm playing this, it's called Resident Evil, it's, you know, you're killing zombies, and like, oh, let me play. And that's your hand controller going down. He's kind of, like, telling me where to go, because I've got no fun. Like, oh yeah, go down this hallway. Yeah, cool. Start walking down the hallway. Does quick cut to some windows that, like, crack or something.
Yeah.
And I'm like, huh? He goes, oh, don't worry about it. I'm like, all right, cool. Continue down the hallway. Zombie on ground, you know, kick its head off. Go back down hall. Dogs! Out of the window.
Yep.
And I just remember, like, I threw the controller up, screaming like a little girl out of the fucking house. Like, that was my first and last time ever playing Resident Evil until 4.
Fuck 4. Controversial opinion, I know, but there were so many good games.
It really is,
that,
because I feel like that game got so many, like, 9s and 10s everywhere.
Yeah. No, everybody seems to love 4 for some reason. That game was so mediocre.
Except for people that legitimately enjoy the Resident Evil series. People that, like, really liked Resident Evil for Resident Evil were like, 4 is complete and utter shit, and IGN was like, Resident Evil 4 is the best game ever made. So yeah, in terms of the gameplay and the story and everything, probably legitimately, honestly, why I have not played a whole lot of Anarchy Reigns. The bits of it that I started playing, I was like, this is decidedly mediocre. Like, if it scores above average on the gameplay scale and the story is complete garbage, I'll probably continue playing it. If it scores below average on the gameplay scale and the story isn't fucking astounding, I will probably quit. And Anarchy Reigns was somewhere in that mediocre level where I was just like, this is kind of like Dynasty Warriors mixed with like a Spectacle Fighter, where I feel like I'm trying to combo a single guy, but my moves aren't that varied, and the movement isn't as fluid, so I didn't really know where to place it. I want to go back now and kind of try it. It's just the matter of setting up a PlayStation 3 in order to do that. I can do it. It's not hard, but it's just time that could be, you know,
yeah,
invested elsewhere. You know, I've bought Warhammer 40k Space Marine twice, and I still have yet to actually play that game.
You bought it twice?
I bought it for like $5 on 360, and then it came up for sale in like a Warhammer bundle that I bought on Steam.
Yeah, I got Space Marine actually, since it's uninstalled, tell me when I bought it. I bought that February 4th, 2012, and I put 70 minutes into it.
I was kind of disappointed with how bodied you got, like, how fast. I was like, I felt like I was wearing a giant suit of power armor and my health was made out of paper.
Well, I was going to go, you were just wearing a cardboard. Yeah, no, I kind of agree with you on that one, where it's just like, I felt like for what you were supposed to be, like, you dropped way too fast, and I didn't really get a good enough hang on the health recovery mechanic of it to really survive long enough.
Oh, spoilers. I thought I bought it twice. I didn't. I bought the Dawn of War pack, which did not come with Space Marine, so I only have Space Marine once, but I've never actually played it.
The Dawn of War games are hella good, though.
Yeah, they're
fun.
Yeah.
That again goes on my list of things. That again goes on my list of things that I will play before I play Homeworld, which is why I will never play Homeworld.
I'm playing Random Select in Rank now because I'm just like... The combo
system... Because you understand the combo system?
Yeah. So, I mean, sure, I'm not going to know like my optimal ranges or my normals or my best combos or anything like that. But it works well enough.
Yeah.
Games I would like to finish, but will probably never force myself to endure the gameplay long enough to actually reach the end of. Deadly Premonition. The best worst video game ever made.
Oh, now my opponent's doing stuff. After I did like 60%.
Yeah, that is not a game. Like, the name rings a bell, but not for, I don't think I've ever actually played it.
So somebody that you used to have a lot of faith in wrote this review for Deadly Premonition, and you should read it at some point and then decide whether or not you ever actually want to play it.
It's Twin Peaks the game.
Ah.
Yeah. Yeah, it really fucking was.
Yeah.
After watching, like, 5 episodes of Twin Peaks, like, I definitely kind of got a lot of that.
Oh, speaking of, because on the Deadly Premonition page, down at the also searched for box is, what is it, D4? What's the deal going on with that?
It's getting another season, supposedly, that's what they tell us. And it's going to be better and longer than the first season. Supposedly, so they tell us.
So yeah. Were there only the 2 games in that season?
Yes.
Or episodes or whatever? Okay.
Yep. That was the whole season. You got prologue, episode 1, episode 2, you were done.
Okay. Yeah, because I only remember you streaming it twice, so.
Yep.
That's why it was kind of like, so what's going on with that?
Literally nothing was explained except for, I think, that big hulking dude that was like all fucked up at the end was D, I think. Maybe, not really sure.
Maybe kinda sorta?
Yeah.
Yeah, like I said, that just popped down and I remember you were doing that one and like nothing has come of it, so I was just like, what's going on?
Yep. It's done. I'll play more of it when there's more of it to play.
Fair enough.
Cupcake was talking about playing RPGs and the 3DS. Fire Emblem Fates, functionally pretty good. The only thing that I don't like about Fire Emblem Fates is that battles will drag out really long, because sometimes the AI is a huge chicken shit. And so I've had a couple battles where the entirety of the fight was me looking at the AI's attack range, kiting, keeping all of my characters just barely out of range of it, and then sticking one person into attack range and having them rush me and then getting completely annihilated. The whole of the game was just baiting the enemy to come at me, because I couldn't move close enough to them to do any damage, and if you stay outside of their attack range, they won't move.
Hmm.
Yeah.
That's awkward.
It's certain missions, certain enemies, but if you, like, stay outside of their attack range, they'll just sit there. They're all pretty much on hold position.
Fun.
Yeah. So it was, there were a few maps like that. The cool thing about it, though, two of the things about it that I really like, number one, it's a strategy RPG. So unless you specifically go searching for, like, grind levels to make your characters better, every single fight is a story fight. Number two is that, because Fire Emblem Awakening was such a divisive game for series fans, there are a bunch of options. You have difficulties. You can play on, like, easy, normal, and insane. And you have varying levels of severity for your characters. One of Fire Emblem's, like, crowning things, one of the big deals about Fire Emblem as a strategy RPG, when everybody used to talk about it, was permadeath. A character dies in combat, they're gone. Dunzo.
Right.
Fire Emblem Awakening basically softened it up for weeaboos and newcomers, and so now with Birthright, your character options are like Phoenix, Casual, and Original, or Standard, or whatever it was called. So Phoenix is, your characters will revive during the current battle. Casual is, your characters will revive after the battle is over. And Standard is permadeath. So to me, that basically means the only way to really play Fire Emblem is with permadeath. The cool thing about, and since this is my first Fire Emblem experience, the cool thing about it is all of my units are characters. Like, I've played Disgaea, I've played some other strategy RPGs where it's just like you have to kind of build an army of kind of faceless units in order to actually function. But every character in my Fire Emblem army is a character. Like, they're not just, you know, swordsman or dragon rider or, you know, soldier A.
Got it.
So, which makes you kind of put a little bit more emotion and effort into keeping everyone alive. So for me, that makes a lot more sense. And so when I'm baiting someone out, when I'm trying to get the enemies to advance on me, I have to go, okay, who has the most health? Who has the highest defense? Who's not gonna get one shot by this guy because of a specific weapon character unit interaction? And that kind of changes how I move around. Because if all I was doing was trying to run into combat to just bait people out, I'd be sending in my Pegasus Knights. But Pegasus Knights pretty much get one shot by bows. So if they have a bunch of bowmen, I need to keep them back. Or if they're at low health, I need to kind of finagle. And then all of my healers don't actually have attack moves, so I need to keep them off the front lines. It makes me think about everything a lot differently than, say, Disgaea did, where it's just like, throw printies at it until it dies.
Fair enough.
So literally throw Prinnies at it, because I don't know if you ever played this guy, but Prinnies were the little penguin dudes.
Things, yeah.
Yeah. If you picked them up and threw them, they exploded. Like, that was a mechanic in-game you could do, was you could lift units and you could throw them in order to increase their movement. And if you threw a Prinny, it just exploded.
Nice.
Yeah.
So here's a game that I think, I know Mike would put on his regret spending money on, and I can't believe we didn't remember this game. Because it asks you to remember it.
Because the entire title was a plea.
Yes. Yeah, remember me, folks.
Fuck.
Oh, God. Didn't one of you stream that beginning to end at some point?
No, I streamed the last half of that game because I was halfway through it. And I was kind of like, oh, whatever, it's meh at this point. And Mike was like, no, you need to finish it. And like, he gave me some incentive to finish it and do it on stream.
Yeah.
So I did it, and yeah, I have the video saved. I probably should upload it, because yeah, that was atrocious.
That meltdown was almost as good as the Danganronpa Chapter 2 meltdown. I'm actually amazed that it wasn't superior to the Danganronpa Chapter 2 meltdown.
Well, they were different types of meltdowns.
One of them was a fuck this game meltdown, and the other one was a what the fuck was that?
Yeah. Yeah, so I think most people who have played Remember Me is on that regret buying list.
Yeah.
Yep. I can't believe, and so when we first, like, so when Cy and I first, like, did a game share on PS4 or PS3, and we were kind of getting streaming or recording set up for Zero Tolerance Games, or maybe we were just looking for something to review.
Yeah, we were looking for something to review, and it was that or BioShock Infinite, and you were like, and BioShock 2 was mediocre, so let's go with Remember Me. And then I got through like the first four chapters in one night, and I told him how awful it was, and he didn't believe me, and he played like the first chapter, and then he was like, oh god, this is horrible. And then I finished it anyway.
Yeah, so having played 30 minutes of Remember Me and 4 or 5 or 6 hours, however long it took me to finish BioShock Infinite to the end, that was an enormous mistake. I think the reason we specifically went with Remember Me was because there wasn't a lot of coverage on it, and like everybody was like universally BioShock Infinite is like game of the year. Air horn.
Yeah, John Cena.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, and then we were just like, well, there's not a lot of coverage on Remember Me, and then we very quickly found out why there wasn't a lot of coverage on Remember Me. Oh my god. I should play Hokuto Musou at some point, but I would also have to hook up my 360 for that, which means I would have to unearth my 360.
Mm-hmm. Two is better.
Probably. Musou games only, the Warriors titles only get better as time goes on. I don't think there's a Warriors title that's been like objectively worse than its predecessor.
I think DW5 or 6. One of them, they like redid everything and everything.
Oh yeah, it was like one of the first ones on PS3, I think.
Yeah.
It was just like a total overhaul. And was actually like a step backwards. So okay.
This guy's PC,
but on a grand, what's that? Oh, on a grander scale, most of the Warriors titles get better as time goes on. So, given that my experience, my original Warriors experience was like DW2 and Samurai Warriors, it kind of sour taste in my mouth.
Fair enough.
DW2, I'm guessing objectively better than DW1.
One
but
hope.
Not a good game. Not a good game. Samurai Warriors was better, but I think Sam Warriors was based off of the DW3 engine, I believe. Fight on. All right, well, we're about running into that 8 p.m. cutoff. We're very nearing it.
Yeah,
I think we've had a lot to talk about.
We're about 2 hours and 45 minutes in. We're doing pretty well.
Yeah, just a little.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I think I'm going to call it because I am both starving and really have to use the bathroom. So, if we want to sign off.
So, that wraps up our first VODcast, whatever you want to call it. Then Mike Tsaikotyk Kelly, joined with our Kim Jong One and only, Mr. Latency.
What's up?
And the Dick Bandit himself, Cupcake Troll.
Heyo!
Thanks for watching, listening, or however you choose to consume this content. Be sure to check us out on Twitch and YouTube.
I was gonna say.
Twitter. I don't know why the YouTube link is on this one. I wasn't thinking. I put the YouTube link on a video I'm putting on YouTube.
Well, you can't promote too much.
Yeah.
No.
I don't have a Twitch link image. We need to work on that.
Yeah. I'll figure that out. I was gonna say, I don't have a Twitch link overlay image because we streamed to Twitch. Like why did I not make one? Because I don't make video content that isn't Twitch related. Yeah, I'll fix that as soon as I get Photoshop reinstalled.
Yep, you know, episode one, proof of concept.
Yep.
We'll refine from here.
And this one might actually get uploaded.
Yeah, it will.
That's a good point.
Wow. Yeah, so podcast success rate going up from 0 out of 3 to 1 out of 4. I think we're on the rise here.
I think this is actually 1 out of 5. I think we had 4 failed betas.
Jesus Christ.
Because I think we tried to do one with Jason at some point.
Maybe? I don't know.
Yeah, who knows? But anyway.
Anyways, cheers. Thanks for watching, listening, subscribing, following, yada, yada, yada.
Yep, have a good one, everyone.